This moment is very meaningful for me. To have been amongst those chosen and blessed by Muhammad himself and affirmed by his wife Lani, to take part by sharing a prose and a statement during this homegoing ceremony. While he and I had a treasured relationship, the genesis of this love was through the love for my father. Muhammad Ali was the last of a fraternity of amazing men bequeathed to me directly by my dad. Somewhere between me turning 18, 19, or 20, they all seemed to find me somehow, guided by an oath or a promise to my dad, long after him leaving this earth, to search for me. And they did, each one remaining in my life until joining the rest of the heavens' beloved summit of fearless humanitarians. This included Muhammad Ali, whom my dad loved as a little brother, 16 years his junior, and his entrusted friend. There was a double take when I came upon him, a once childhood first child, and now looking right into his face, and you know how he is, you know, he gives you that little dare, like, is that you? From the very moment we found one another, it was as if no time had passed at all, despite all of the presumptions of division, despite all the efforts at separation, despite all of the organized distancing. We dove right into all of the unrequited, yet stated and duly acknowledged spaces we could explore and uncover privately. We cried out loud. His belt, his grief for having not spoken to my dad before he left. And then just as loudly, we'd laugh about the best of stories and some that can't be repeated. He was really funny. What was significant as brothers for my father and Ali was their ability to discuss openly anything, all facets of life, namely the true meaning as men with great responsibilities bestowed to them, of how to make an equitable difference in the lives of others. A unifying topic was faith, an ecumenical faith, respect for faith, all faiths, even if belonging to one specific religion or none, the root of such being the gift of faith itself. So in his own words, he wrote, "We all have the same God. We just serve him differently. Rivers, lakes, ponds, streams, oceans, all have different names, but they all contain water. So do religions have different names, and yet they all contain truth. Truth expressed in different ways and forms and times. It doesn't matter whether you're a Muslim, a Christian, or a Jew. When you believe in God, you should believe all people are part of one family." "For if you love God, you can't love only some of his children. His words, and certainly ideals shared by both men. Love is a mighty thing. Devotion is a mighty thing. And truth always reigns. Having Muhammad Ali in my life somehow sustained my dad's breath for me. Just a little while longer, 51 years longer, until now. I am forever grateful that our union on this earth together allowed for me a continuum of shared understanding, preserved confidentialities, and the comfort of living in his hometown of Louisville, Kentucky for the past 6 years. That was not a plan. And mostly for the gift of knowing and loving his wife and children forever forward, as my own family know that. As the last of the fraternity reaches the heavens, my heart is rendered ever longingly for that tribe. Tribe of purpose, tribe of significance, tribe of confidence, tribe of character, tribe of duty, tribe of faith, tribe of service. We must make sure that the principle of men and women like Muhammad Ali and others, whom dedicated their very being to assure that you get to recognize your own glory, is sustained and passed on like that Olympic torch. My dad would often state when concluding or parting from another, may we meet again in the light of understanding. And I say to you, with the light of that compass, by any means necessary.
Context of White Supremacy, Gus T. Renegade, in for another broadcast, hopefully to share constructive information on the system of white supremacy. Today's date, Friday, July 15th, 2016, so I have been told. The audio segment you heard at the beginning of the program, that was Ambassador Atala Shabazz, that is Minister Malcolm X's eldest daughter. She was speaking at the memorial service for the late greatest of all time, Muhammad Ali, his transition in the summer of 2016, just literally a few days back, when she was able to speak and give some of her thoughts, condolences to the family, and direct memories. Given his recent passing, I thought it would be a great time to revisit not only the life and times of Muhammad Ali, but Minister Malcolm X and the relationship between the two. The book that was also just published this year, literally months before the passing of Muhammad Ali, Blood Brothers, The Fatal Friendship Between Muhammad Ali and Malcolm X. The book published, written, co-authored by Randy Roberts and Johnny Smith. They are both suspected racists, so certainly have your ears attuned. Be paying attention to word choice and how this information is presented to us. I haven't read it yet, so I'm reading it for the first time with you all. Folks that have read it have said it is a fantastic read and really makes the point why we should avoid name-calling other black people, one of Mr. Fuller's 10 stops. Without further ado, we will get started. Context of White Supremacy, Blood Brothers, audio segment number one.
Tentor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Blood Brothers, The Fatal Friendship Between Muhammad Ali and Malcolm X, by Randy Roberts and Johnny Smith, narrated by David Drummond. Preface. A Dream Deferred. Malcolm X and Ali were like very close brothers. It was almost as if they were in love with each other. Ferdy Pacheco, Muhammad Ali's physician. What happens to a dream deferred? Langston Hughes asked in one of his most moving and insightful poems. Does it dry up like a raisin in the sun? Or does it explode? We ask the same questions about the lives of two extraordinarily gifted men, both born in a segregated land and raised amidst pain and discrimination to face a violent world. What happens to a dream deferred? Does it snake toward hopelessness, despair, drunkenness, addiction, and poverty? Or does it explode in rage? A dream deferred, Malcolm X knew, could become an American nightmare. Our story begins with two questions. Who was Cassius Clay, and how did he become Muhammad Ali? As much as has been written about him, he remains enigmatic, a silent sphinx. He has meant different things to different people at different times. it has become increasingly difficult to know the Muhammad Ali of the 1960s. Since the end of the Vietnam War, liberal writers have manufactured an image of him as a hero of social causes, a unifying force of goodwill. He is no longer seen as controversial, threatening, or anti-American. His legacy has become distorted and trivialized. In a tragic irony, Parkinson's disease has robbed him of his verbal gifts. Once known as the Louisville Lip, Ali no longer boasts, rhymes, or raps. His silence has been filled by corporate sponsors, movie producers, and writers who have created a new voice for him, a voice that neither preaches racial separation nor acknowledges his past with Malcolm X. A minister in the Nation of Islam, NOI, Malcolm espoused racially charged rhetoric about devilish white men, brainwashed Christian Negroes, and bloody revolution. Many feared that he might organize the opening battle of an impending race war. Muhammad Ali called this man his brother, leading critics to vilify him as a disgrace to boxing. At first, Cassius Clay, as he was known until 1964, hid his relationship with Malcolm. A master of deception, he proved infuriatingly elusive for journalists. Figuring out who or what is the real Cassius Clay is a parlor game that has become unrewarding even for experts, commented Jack Olson, a white writer who gained unprecedented access to the fighter. Clay's personality is like a jigsaw puzzle whose pieces were cut by a drunken carpenter, a jumbled collection of moods and attitudes that do not seem to interlock. Sometimes he sounds like a religious fanatic, his voice sing-song and chanting, and all at once he will turn into a calm, reasoning, if confused, student of the scriptures. He is a loudmouth windbag, and at the same time a remarkably sincere and dedicated athlete. He can be a kindly benefactor of the neighborhood children and a vicious bully in the ring, a prissy Puritan, totally intolerant of drinkers and smokers, and a teller of dirty jokes. In 1966, when Olson began writing Black is Best, a lengthy profile of the boxer, piecing together the jigsaw puzzle of Muhammad Ali seemed impossible. Yet what Olson and other writers have failed to recognize is that the real Muhammad Ali can only be seen when his many masks are uncovered. From 1960 to 1965, the half-decade that framed his relationship with Malcolm X, he appeared convincingly as four different personalities, packaged and expressed at different times for different audiences. He first emerged on the world stage as Cassius Marcellus Clay Jr. of the 1960 Rome Olympics. Wide-eyed, talkative, enthusiastic, and likable, a defender of the glacial progress being made in American race relations. In Rome, Cassius proudly told a Soviet reporter who asked him about the American color line, "We've got qualified people working on that problem, and I'm not worried about the outcome. To me, the USA is still the best country in the world, counting yours." As Cassius Marcellus Clay Jr., he was the quiet Southern Negro, downplaying racial conflict and avoiding controversy. After turning professional toward the end of 1960, he became the Louisville Lip, boasting loudly, spouting poetry, belittling opponents, and advertising himself. As the Louisville Lip, he became the booming athletic equivalent of Little Richard and Elvis Presley, echoing the raucous notes of rock and roll and the television antics of professional wrestler Gorgeous George. As the civil rights movement escalated from 1962 to early 1964, he evolved into Cassius X, the loyal follower of Elijah Muhammad, the supreme minister of the Nation of Islam. As Cassius X, a name he adopted only for a brief time, he imitated Malcolm, appearing angry and outraged by racial injustice. Behind the walls of the nation's mosques, he stood up as an outspoken defender of the Black Muslim philosophy, one that promoted racial pride, self-determination, and complete separation of the races. As an acolyte of Elijah Muhammad and Malcolm X, he defiantly opposed Martin Luther King's approach to the civil rights movement and the ideals of racial integration. Finally, after winning the heavyweight title in February 1964, he became Muhammad Ali. Renamed by Elijah, pride apart from Malcolm, and the new frontman for the Nation of Islam. As in his other personas, he inhabited the role of Muhammad Ali, often wearing the somber, stone-faced mask of Elijah's paramilitary followers. As Muhammad Ali, he instantly became the most politically controversial athlete in the country's history. Cassius Marcellus Clay Jr., the Louisville Lip, Cassius X, and Muhammad Ali. The boxer played all these roles, wearing the different masks as the occasion dictated. He was all of these characters, and sometimes more than one at the same moment. "I don't have to be what you want me to be," he once announced. "I'm free to be who I want." Yet some of the men closest to him had trouble understanding exactly who he was free to be. "They say there's 15 sides to Clay," his ring physician Ferdy Pacheco said. "To me, he's just a thoroughly confused person. Sure, he has sides, but they don't mesh." Only by examining Cassius Clay's early years in Louisville and his relationship with Malcolm X can one hope to discover Muhammad Ali. Central to his life, relationships, and career was deception. Disguise and dissemblance, of course, have been integral to African-American culture since the first moments of contact between blacks and whites. From the stories of Brer Rabbit's trickery and indirection to such novels as Richard Wright's Native Son and Ralph Ellison's Invisible Man, the ability of black Americans to wear disguises and assume multiple identities has been crucial in navigating the boundaries and pathways of the color line in America. But beyond African-American culture, the volatile circumstances of young Cassius Clay's home life created an atmosphere conducive to disguise. That he entered a profession that rewarded violence and deception, a trade that trafficked in feints, fakes, and pain, indicates how ingrained those qualities were in his life. If Olson, Pacheco, and others could not figure out the riddle of Cassius Clay, that attested to how well he had learned to hide himself. Like Muhammad Ali, Malcolm X was also a man of many masks. The seventh son of an itinerant Baptist preacher, Malcolm Little inherited his father's rage against white supremacy. As a young man in the 1940s, he came of age as Detroit Red, a street hustler strutting in a zoot suit, peddling drugs and prostitutes. In the smoky pool halls and jazz clubs of Boston and New York, he developed the swagger of a trickster, cultivating the cool pose of the hip cats he admired. Behind the mask of Detroit Red, he buried the pain of his past. In prison for larceny, his fellow convicts called him Satan. Voraciously reading history, sociology, and theology, he transformed himself into a puritanical follower of Elijah Muhammad, the self-proclaimed messenger of Allah. From his cell, he absorbed and memorized Muhammad's writings and speeches, accepting his message of separatism and strict morality. By the mid-1950s, the former convict had become the messenger's protege, Malcolm X, an outspoken minister saving lost souls in bars, nightclubs, and back alleys. As Malcolm X, he was a model of redemption, preaching a doctrine of abstinence from drugs, alcohol, and crime. The angriest black man in America divided the country with his sharp tongue and brutal honesty, openly condemning whites for terrorizing black Americans. Ultimately, the internal politics of the Nation of Islam and his own crisis of faith led him on a journey toward the universalism of Sunni Islam. In Africa and the Middle East, he was known as El-Hajj Malik El-Shabazz, but he would forever be remembered in America as Malcolm X. Malcolm may have changed his name, but at his core, he remained the same dedicated freedom fighter. Fiercely uncompromising, he carried himself with an imperial restraint, striking a cool posture that could intimidate the most self-assured white man. For Malcolm, coolness meant speaking his mind, refusing to submit to white authority. Being cool meant being completely free. In many ways, Malcolm X and Cassius Clay seemed the product of the same DNA. Both thrived on center stage, surrounded by an audience. Standing beneath the spotlight, at Malcolm's pulpit or in Clay's ring, they responded to the thundering sound of applause and the deafening chorus of boos. Neither man could resist a platform, an interview, or a debate. Both enjoyed sparring with words and manipulating other men's fears with sensational language. They were both fighters. Before Cassius X became Muhammad Ali, Malcolm saw something in the young boxer that no one else did. "Not many people know the quality of the mind he's got in there," he told writer George Plimpton in 1964. Like Malcolm, he was absolutely self-assured, proud, and defiant. He carried himself with boundless confidence, boldly professing his own greatness the way that Malcolm fearlessly denounced white America. Studying Clay's interactions with reporters, the way he spellbound audiences with his performances, Malcolm realized that he could become something more than an athlete. As the heavyweight champion of the world, Clay possessed the kind of far-reaching cultural power that could unify black people. Recognizing Clay's global fame, Malcolm exploited him. Envisioning a new movement that fused together Clay's world and his into one built around celebrity and politics. A myth has enshrouded the encounters between Malcolm X and Muhammad Ali. The stories are told and retold, fashioned in ways that obscure the reality. An anecdote here, a quote there, and before you know it, a fabricated truth has emerged. Drawing on a few unsubstantiated observations by writer Alex Haley and a couple of self-serving comments by Malcolm X and Muhammad Ali, historians and biographers have manufactured a convenient morality play involving two men who came together, formed a deep relationship, and then suddenly and dramatically broke apart. End of story. It was almost as if the two larger-than-life figures were planets, swinging close to each other in their orbits, and then moving apart on separate paths. But it was never that simple. Although their respective biographers have neglected to show that Ali and Malcolm were much more important to one another than previously acknowledged, we have uncovered and interpreted previously unexamined documents that reveal the personal and political dynamics between them. The complex friendship between Malcolm and Ali is interred in a labyrinthine jungle of sources. The private papers of Malcolm X, Alex Haley, and others, FBI files and surveillance reports, State Department records, archived news footage and television programs, long unexamined interview transcripts, new interviews with people who knew Ali and Malcolm intimately, the daily press, and a variety of other published and unpublished materials. Investigating their relationship, we have reconstructed the lives and movements of Ali and Malcolm, focusing especially on the period from the time they met in June 1962 through February 1965. Plotting their daily activities provided a key to deciphering redacted FBI files, revealing the events and conversations recorded in the Bureau's records in a new light. Using these unique sources, we tracked their movements and, in the process, discovered how historians and biographers have misread the complicated relationship between them. In the generally accepted narrative, writers maintain that Ali severed his friendship with Malcolm the moment Elijah renamed him. These authors have relied on a quote that Ali allegedly gave Alex Haley during an interview in Harlem, one that Haley excluded from the published account in Playboy. In fact, nowhere in the Playboy interview is there any mention of Malcolm or why Ali turned his back on him in allegiance to Elijah Muhammad. In the epilogue of The Autobiography of Malcolm X, however, published 7 months after Malcolm's death, Haley recounted his memory of the interview with Ali. According to Haley, Ali said, "You just don't buck Mr. Muhammad and get away with it. I don't want to talk about Malcolm no more." It is likely that during his research for the epilogue, Haley read a nearly identical quote Ali gave Ebony in September 1964, when he said, "You just don't buck Mr. Muhammad and get away with it." Using Haley's quote, several accomplished biographers and historians have mistakenly suggested that Ali made this statement to Haley during the week after Elijah Muhammad renamed him on March 6, 1964. But Ali was not in Harlem at that time, and more importantly, Haley conducted the interview after the boxer returned from Africa on June 24, 1964. Accepting his chronology of events, writers have simplified the complex feelings Ali had for Malcolm. Yet, in Haley's unpublished notes from the Playboy interview, he scribbled on an index card a comment from Ali that revealed the champ's hidden feelings, contradicting the epilogue in the autobiography of Malcolm X. Haley's index card indicated that Ali told him that although he followed Elijah Muhammad, Malcolm was still my brother and my friend. According to Haley, shortly after the interview, he mentioned his meeting with Ali to Malcolm. Curious, Malcolm asked what the champ had said about him. Haley wrote that he pulled out the index card with Ali's comment about Malcolm and handed it to the minister. After leading readers to believe that Ali had only cross words for Malcolm, Haley wrote in the autobiography, "Malcolm X stared at the card, then out of the window, and he got up and walked around. It was one of the few times I ever heard his voice betray his hurt." Sadly, Malcolm said, "I felt like a blood big brother to him." Taking a deep breath, he added, "I'm not against him now. He's a fine young man. Smart. He's just let himself be used, led astray." Under great financial stress to make the autobiography of Malcolm X a publishing success, it appears that Haley manipulated Malcolm's broken relationship with Ali in order to present a more sensational historical account. Throughout the epilogue, Haley selected and excluded events that fit into his agenda. In some cases, he tampered with the facts. But the truth was more complex than Haley let on. Only by carefully following the day-by-day activities of Ali and Malcolm can one see how intertwined their lives became and how their brotherhood unraveled, leading inexorably to Malcolm's assassination at the Audubon Ballroom. We have tried to rescue a story that has fallen into the hands of hagiographers. Blood Brothers explores the importance of two of the most important black men of the 1960s. By following their lives, we have discovered that Cassius Clay had begun attending meetings organized by the Nation of Islam well before any reporter caught wind of it. Even before he became a professional boxer, Clay became infatuated with the teachings of Elijah Muhammad and Malcolm. What follows is the story of how Cassius Clay became Muhammad Ali, and the central role Malcolm X played in his life. It is a tale of friendship and brotherhood, love and deep affection. It is also a story of deceit, betrayal, and violence inside and outside the ring during a troubled time. When Malcolm's life was in danger, when Elijah Muhammad threatened to cast him outside the Nation of Islam, Clay became the central figure in his world. For the first time, Blood Brothers reveals that the instant Malcolm realized he might be murdered, he tethered his future, his very survival, to the life of a boxer who most people figured would never win the heavyweight championship. Malcolm had no doubt that someone inside the Nation wanted him dead. He also knew that none of Elijah's disciples would risk Clay's life. As long as they were together, Malcolm figured, he was safe. Cassius was the perfect shield. However, only 10 days after they celebrated the boxers' championship victory over Sonny Liston, Cassius stopped taking Malcolm's phone calls. Submitting to Elijah, the champ accepted a new name and the Supreme Minister's edict that all Muslims cease contact with Malcolm. Once Muhammad Ali sided with Elijah, Malcolm knew that he could no longer hide behind him. At that moment, he recognized that losing Ali's cover might cost him his life. Ali understood the violent world Malcolm inhabited. Boxing reflected a violent society. "Violence and hate," explained former heavyweight champion Floyd Patterson, "were part of the prizefighter's world, Clay's world and mine. Boxing promoters paid prizefighters to get in the ring and act out other people's hates. Only in that ring of hate could a black man assault a white man with impunity." Like many young black men born into segregation and contained by white supremacy and the threat of mob violence, Ali channeled his fears and frustrations into the ring. In boxing gyms, he released his anger, sweating out his bile against a system of racial oppression, pummeling men who stood between him and his dreams. Ali fought not only because boxing offered him a way to make a name for himself, but also because the gym offered a sanctuary from the dangers lurking outside. The gym became the one place where he could unleash his frustrations on speed bags, heavy bags, and sparring partners. At a time when black men yearned for power, he confronted the dangers of a violent world by retaliating with violence himself. What white America demands in her black champions, Black Panther Eldridge Cleaver insisted, is a brilliant, powerful body and a dull, bestial mind. A tiger in the ring and a pussycat outside the ring. Black boxers' lives, Cleaver maintained, were sharply circumscribed by the ropes around the ring. But Ali completely rejected the worn-out role. By redefining the political boundaries of sports, he ushered in the beginning of a new era, the revolt of the black athlete. The seeds of the revolt were planted in the cities that transformed Cassius Clay into Muhammad Ali. Between 1960 and 1965, he traveled widely, fighting in Rome and London, New York and Los Angeles. When he left Louisville as a teenager, he entered a new world, one that exposed him to the possibilities of freedom beyond the American South. Yet the world beyond Louisville also taught him that no matter how famous he became, some white people would hate him just because he was black or because he was a Muslim. In gyms and mosques across the country, he matured into a man influenced by the discontent in black America. In Chicago and Detroit, Miami and New York, he heard frustrated black men denounce the crimes of white men. Listening to Elijah Muhammad and Malcolm X led him to change more than his name. When he won the heavyweight championship in February 1964, he broke free from the political constraints of the sports world, declaring that he would define himself on his own terms. When he boldly proclaimed, "I'm free to be who I want," he became a source of inspiration for others who would later challenge the sports establishment. In 1969, about a year after sociologist Harry Edwards organized black athletes in an Olympic boycott movement, he observed that Ali had been the central hero in the political revolution in sports. Ali, he proclaimed, was the warrior saint in the revolt of the black athlete in America. That revolt began the moment young Cassius Clay had his first talk with Malcolm. Once Clay met Malcolm, once the personal narrative became a political one, the ring and the playing field were no longer sacred spaces. The relationship between Cassius Clay and Malcolm X signaled a new direction in American culture, one shaped by the forces of sports and entertainment, race and politics. When Clay befriended Malcolm and adopted his ideology, he became the most visible, politically conscious athlete in America. More than anyone else, Malcolm molded Cassius Clay into Muhammad Ali. Under Malcolm's tutelage, he embraced the world stage, emerging as an international symbol of black pride and black independence. Without Malcolm, Muhammad Ali would have never become the king of the world. Prologue. Behind the veil. Through a veil, I could perceive the forbidden city, the Louisville where white folks lived. On my side of the veil, everything was black. The homes, the people, the churches, the schools, the Negro Park with Negro Park police. I knew that there were two Louisvilles, and in America, two Americas. I knew also which of the two Americas was mine. I was a Negro. An act of God had circumscribed my life. Blyden Jackson, The Waiting Years. He never lifted the veil, not when he was Cassius Marcellus Clay, Jr., or after he became Muhammad Ali. Some things he would talk about incessantly, his greatness, his beauty, and his rendezvous with destiny. Other matters he would discuss in more serious moods, the history of the black man in America, black Muslim theology, and, after he became an Orthodox Muslim, universal peace. Yet he seldom whispered a word about the discord in his own family. There was a lot of trouble, bad trouble, between his father and his mother, recalled one of the boxer's early advisors, but Cassius would bite his tongue before he mentioned it. It was a dime a dozen domestic battery, out in the colored district of Louisville's West End. On the hot night of August 8, 1957, Officer Kalbfleisch took the call. When he arrived at 3202 Grand Avenue, an older man took off running, darting between houses and into the night. Two young boys huddled close to their crying mother, whispering to her in a comforting manner. One of the youths was bleeding from a knife wound. Years later, Kalbfleisch couldn't remember if the boy had been cut on his ass or on his thigh, but it was in the meat and bleeding pretty good. When asked about the gash, the teenager said that he had cut it on a milk bottle. It was an unlikely story. The father had bolted when he saw the police car. The mother, the policeman later told a reporter, was causing trouble. "You know how women are." Kalbfleisch got the picture. The father got drunk, began to beat his wife, her son tried to protect her, and got cut for his efforts. It was not the first time that Mrs. Odessa Clay had called the police, nor was it the last. The injured son, only 15 years old, identified himself. "My name is Cassius Clay," he said. "I'm a boxer under Joe Martin." The name Cassius Clay meant nothing to Kalbfleisch, but he knew Joe Martin. A patrolman who in his spare time trained young boxers at Columbia Gym, Martin produced a local television program called Tomorrow's Champions. Not many of the kids who fought each other on the weekly telecasts ever won titles, but the mere fact that they were seen on TV granted them a certain local celebrity. And Cassius was one of them, a kid from the tough side of town whose transitory fame still proved no defense against a drunk, angry father. Kalbfleisch could have filed a formal report at police headquarters, but he let it slide. "I said to myself, well, there ain't going to be no prosecution anyway, so I said to the mother, now look, take him to your doctor or take him to the hospital, and if you want to, go up and take out a malicious cutting warrant." But the officer knew that the incident would end there. Mr. Clay would return soon enough, and life would go on as before. All that remains of the episode is a few lines in the duty record book. August 8, 1957, 10:32 p.m., Mrs. Clay, cutting investigation, 3302 Grand, no arrest. Cassius Marcellus Clay, Jr. grew up living in fear. Fear of his father's raised fist, the smell of alcohol on his breath, and his rising, angry voice bursting through the front door. He also feared what would happen if he did not heed his father's warnings about the dangers lurking outside their home. Repeatedly, the man exhorted his boys, "Don't leave our neighborhood. Don't go into white people's stores. Don't contradict a white man. Don't look at white women. Don't disobey policemen. And most importantly, don't get arrested." "Our parents taught us to be safe," said Bob Coleman, a childhood friend of Cassius Clay. "And they knew that if I got arrested by a policeman, there was nothing they could do to help me. It would be like I was lost to them. I would be on my own. That scared them as much as me." Cassius Clay Sr. told parables that taught young Cassius and his brother Rudy about the world. All the stories had the same general theme. Black men die after seemingly harmless encounters with white men. The murders, Clay Sr. insisted, were legal lynchings. "They happened all the time," he said. "When I was a boy, seemed like every darn day you'd read in the paper about something like that, a lynching, a burning of a Negro, every day. Now wouldn't that turn you against the white man? 9 or 10 or 12 or 15 cases like that a week?" The past haunted Clay Sr., and it lived on in the stories he told his sons. Living in a world of intolerable racism and violence, Clay Sr.'s frustration manifested in outward rage and loathing for the white man. As James Baldwin wrote in 1962, "The Negro's past was one of rope, fire, torture, castration, infanticide, rape, death and humiliation, fear by day and night, fear as deep as the marrow of the bone, doubt that he was worthy of life, since everyone around him denied it. Sorrow for his women, for his kinfolk, for his children, who needed his protection and whom he could not protect." In the words of Baldwin, This hatred for white men ran so deep that it often turned against him and his own, and made all love, all trust, all joy impossible. Clay Sr. threw his entire body into the stories he told, twisting, snorting, huffing, and punctuating key points with a loud, "Mm-hmm," or an inopportune laugh. A natural storyteller, he moved gracefully from humor to tragedy, carrying the listener along with him. He was an exasperated artist who earned a living as a sign painter. A wiry, dark-skinned man, opinionated and outspoken, he was not much of a fighter, except when he was drunk. Then he was apt to turn on his family. But he was also a teller of tall tales, most of which centered on his fantasy life. Given his mood of the moment, he might claim to be a Mexican, a Hindu, or an Arab. During his Mexican phase, he wore a serape and took siestas. During his Arab period, he called his second son Rudolph Valentino, after the actor who portrayed the Hollywood sheik. A friend recalled that during Clay Sr.'s time as an Arab, he observed certain rituals. At noon, he used to get down off his painting ladder, and in his little box he had a carpet, and he'd put the carpet down and bow to the east, and then bow to the west. All his life, Clay Sr. struggled. A friend of the family said he enjoyed life, by which he meant he took his pleasures where he found them and didn't worry excessively about propriety and consequences. But a streak of anger, a sense of opportunities denied, ran like a river through his life. Had he been white, he thought, he would have been famous and wealthy. His murals on walls and churches in the West End of Louisville attested to his talents, and he could sing any song in his thin baritone. "Yes, sir," he said. He could have been a great artist or recording star. Like the other greats, all he needed was a little more training. "Nat King Cole was nothing when he started out," he said. "And Dean Martin was nothing. Frank Sinatra was sickening. Frank Sinatra was sickening." Cassius Clay Jr. was a mama's boy, handsome, sweet, and well-liked. He feared his father, avoided violence, and abhorred alcohol. But in fundamental ways, he was his father's son, and he would become more so as the years passed. His father's stories made all too much sense of the violent world inside and outside his home. Two events were enough to confirm all of his father's gruesome tales of horror. The first happened within a 4 or 5 minute drive of Clay's home on Grand Avenue. In 1954, Andrew Wade IV, an African-American electrician, and his wife, Charlotte, arranged for a white couple to purchase a house for them in an all-white suburban neighborhood. Their new neighbors immediately and angrily reacted, insisting that the Wades sell their house and move. When the Wades refused, they received ominous threats, followed by a cross-burning on their lawn. Later, someone fired a rifle through a window in their house. Still, the Wades stayed put. Finally, on the night of June 27, 1954, while the Wades were gone for the evening, someone dynamited the house. There was no justice in the case. The person who ignited the bomb was never identified, and the Wades were forced to move into the segregated West End. It was another example of what Clay Sr. told his son: the white man doesn't want you around. He explained that, in America, the black man could never get ahead. Cassius asked why. If he worked hard, why couldn't he become a rich man? Why couldn't he share in the American dream? His father pointed to the skin on Cassius's arm. "Look there. That's why you can't be rich." The second event, and for Cassius, the more emotionally searing, occurred the following summer. Emmett Till's mother had packed him off to visit family members in Money, Mississippi, and not long after his arrival in the small town, he and his cousin and several local boys went to Bryant's Grocery and Meat Market to buy some candy. While in the store, Till whistled while speaking to Carolyn Bryant. It may have been a wolf whistle, as some recalled, or perhaps due to his problem pronouncing B words, he whistled before asking for bubblegum. Regardless, Bryant later told her husband that Till had made a pass at her. Enraged, Roy Bryant and his half-brother J.W. Milam went after Till. They pulled him from his uncle's home, pistol-whipped him, beat him, and finally shot him in the head. Then they attached a heavy cotton gin fan to his neck with barbed wire and dumped him into the Tallahatchie River. In a sensational 5-day trial, held in a packed courthouse and attended by nationally prominent reporters, Bryant and Milam were tried for kidnapping and murder. After listening to all the evidence, the all-white jury deliberated for 67 minutes before voting to acquit the two men. "If we hadn't stopped to drink a pop," commented a juror, "it wouldn't have taken that long." The trial, along with Till's shocking open casket funeral in Chicago, energized the civil rights movement and stood as a stark confirmation of what black males had long been taught. Justice was not colorblind. That lesson was not lost on young Cassius Clay. 20 years after the event, he recalled looking at the pictures of Till's mutilated face in the pages of Jet magazine, horrified by the sight of his eyes bulging out of their sockets and his mouth twisted and broken. He would never forget those images, or the grisly stories his father told him about the crime. Mississippi justice was not confined to the South. Malcolm Little felt trapped by the same realities that pained Blyden Jackson, frustrated Clay Sr., frightened Cassius Jr., and killed Emmett Till. Writers often asked Malcolm when he first experienced racial inequality, as if he were a test subject whose anger could easily be reduced to some isolated incident. In March 1964, shortly after Clay won the heavyweight championship, a Swedish television reporter inquired about the psychological scars that Malcolm carried from his youth. "When did segregation first hurt him?" Irritated, he quipped, "When I was born. I was born in a segregated hospital of a segregated mother and father." Intrigued by his provocative answer, the writer pressed further. "The first was when we were living in Lansing, Michigan, in an integrated neighborhood." One evening, when Malcolm was only 6 years old, he woke up and found the house on fire. The good Christians of the neighborhood had come out and set the house afire. The second was when my father was found under a streetcar where he had been thrown by the good Christians. That's my second. Grinning derisively, he paused, looking directly into the television camera. "You want my third and fourth and fifth and sixth and seventh?" He never knew for sure how his father ended up under the streetcar. The coroner ruled Earl Little Sr.'s death accidental. But growing up fatherless, all but certain that white supremacists had killed his dad, Malcolm was embittered from an early age. He often told white journalists, "Your father isn't here to pay his debts. My father isn't here to collect. But I'm here to collect, and you're here to pay." Burdened by their father's broken dreams and shattered lives, Malcolm Little and Cassius Clay transformed the deep pain and anger that they felt into an unshakable pride. Tormented by the past, they resisted the brutality of America, relentlessly pursuing redemption. One man was scarred by his father's absence, the other by his father's presence. They shared the kind of anguish and love that only a brother could understand. Chapter 1. The Mothership in Miami. "As a kid in Louisville, the city seemed so big to me. New York seemed so big. Chicago seemed big. And London, England seemed far away. Africa was far away. I was Cassius Clay then. I was a Negro. I ate pork. I had no confidence. I thought white people were superior. I was a Christian Baptist named Cassius Clay." Muhammad Ali. Clay is a product of our times. The minute he got back from Rome, the saga started. Milton Gross, New York Post. 304 mostly flat cornfield miles after it departed Chicago's Union Station, the South Wind passenger train rolled into Louisville's Union Station. There, on December 17, 1960, a young man stepped aboard, toting a worn suitcase and a pocketful of dreams. Cassius Marcellus Clay, Jr. was 18, tall and slender. with a handsome, unmarked face. His body was deceptively lithe, like a dancer's, but he was a professional prize fighter. His electric smile could light up an arena, though he was haunted by fears, real and imagined. He had won a gold medal in the Rome Olympics, charmed the press corps and fellow athletes in the Eternal City, and signed a lucrative promotional contract with a collection of white Kentucky movers and shakers known as the Louisville Sponsoring Group, LSG. It was that group, most of whom were millionaires, that had paid for his train ticket. After the brief stop in Louisville, the south wind chugged over the rolling hills of Kentucky, through a narrow, river-veined section of Tennessee, and then across the border into Alabama. Looking out the window, as evening turned into night, Cassius saw mile after mile of the cotton south as the train made its way through the heart of the old Confederacy, stopping to pick up more passengers in Decatur, Birmingham, Montgomery, and Dothan. It was those sections of Dixie, those cities ruled by King Cotton, where the civil rights struggle would soon turn bitterly violent. There, many white Southerners stood armed and ready to defend their way of life, certain in their conviction of black inferiority. While in Italy, however, Cassius had felt a freedom that he had never experienced growing up in the segregated West End of Louisville. As a member of the United States Olympic team, he had witnessed black excellence. Rafer Johnson had carried the American flag in the opening ceremonies and then won the prestigious decathlon. Oscar Robertson had led the basketball team to the gold medal. And the incomparable Wilma Rudolph, who ran as gracefully as water being poured out of a pitcher, fired the imaginations of people around the globe. Together, Rafer, Oscar, Wilma, and Cassius reigned in Rome like ebony gods. If there was royalty at the Olympics, they were it. After Alabama, the south wind passed through the southwest corner of Georgia and entered Florida, stopping briefly in Jacksonville in the early morning before continuing its crisscrossing route through the state, stopping more often now to drop off tourists at such resort towns as Orlando, Tampa, St. Petersburg, West Palm Beach, Delray Beach, Fort Lauderdale, and Hollywood, before reaching its destination of Miami. There, roughly 24 hours after boarding the train, Cassius got off. It had been a long trip, but to his way of thinking, riding the train was infinitely preferable to flying, and it had given him some time to plan and dream. He was in the Deep South, a place where white residents still generally regarded Jim Crow as the accepted code of life and believed that a Negro should know his place. Even so, Cassius Clay had glimpsed an alternative reality, and he knew with every fiber of his being that he was destined to leave his mark on the world. "I am a man of destiny," he had said less than a year before. "I'm going to win the heavyweight championship of the world, earn $1 million, and get me a chauffeur-driven tomato-red Cadillac with a built-in hi-fi, television, and telephones." And that was only for starters. There would be more. Later, he admitted, "I guess some sort of divine power must have been with me." He had come to Miami to learn a trade that would make him rich. What he did not anticipate was that a divine message would set him on the path to becoming Muhammad Ali. Waiting patiently for the boxer was trainer Angelo Dundee. His name, an alias that mixed the hills of Calabria with the grime of Scotland, said more about his profession than his personality. His real name was Angelo Morena, but Dundee was such a popular name in prize fighting that his older brother Chris adopted it when he entered the profession. Soon, Angelo followed Chris and took the same name. After World War II, Chris began to promote fights in New York City, and Angelo apprenticed as a trainer. In 1951, when the boxing business became sluggish in New York, Angelo followed Chris to Miami, where the older brother had established a promotional arrangement with the newly built Miami Beach Auditorium. By the mid-1950s, Angelo had been around boxing for a decade and had learned the craft of training boxers from the tobacco-crusted floor up. His was a hands-on education, learning by talking to and watching the very best trainers in the sport. By the end of 1960, just short of his 40th birthday, he had carved out a place for himself in the fight game. He had trained welterweight and middleweight champion Carmen Basilio, as well as a stable of fighters who would soon win other titles. Short and round-faced, with bulging dark eyes, floppy ears, and thinning black hair, Dundee liked his pants high-waisted, his trainer's bag well-ordered, and his life as peaceful as his chaotic profession allowed. Like that of many men in his world, his personality did not seem to fit the boxing profession. Fiercely loyal to his fighters, and capable of all sorts of chicanery in the pursuit of victory, he was in all other ways a gentle, gracious man, who sought nothing more than tranquility. He readily chatted with strangers, he was open and friendly with sports writers, and he did his best to please everyone. The model of discretion, he refused to get involved in marital scraps, religious controversies, or political differences. Over the years, he had learned to smile, listen, and mind his own business. Keeping his mouth shut around Cassius, Angelo learned, was easy. No sooner had Clay stepped off the South Wind than he began singing his own praises. "People say Cassius Clay fights like Sugar Ray," he told Angelo, as well as anyone within earshot. Dick Sadler, Archie Moore's trainer, who had worked with Cassius for a short time in San Diego, had told Angelo if he trained the kid, he deserved a purple heart with 7 clusters. It did not take Dundee long to understand the cryptic warning. From the train station, Angelo drove to Colored Town, where he had arranged for Clay to share a room at the Charles Hotel with a Jamaican heavyweight. Dundee thought that there were 2 beds in the room, but there was only a double bed for 2 heavyweight boxers. Furthermore, since Angelo received a discount on the room, the management recouped some of its loss by not installing an air conditioner. The Spartan, low-rent condition of the room was matched by the neighborhood. Ferdy Pacheco, who would soon become Clay's fight doctor and had a medical practice close to the Charles Hotel, called the area a hellhole of pimps, hookers, drug dealers, winos, and general bad guys. It was a no-man's land that slept till late in the morning, took a siesta in the afternoon, and then came alive with an adrenaline rush at night. Its after-midnight scene offered 1,000 temptations. Marijuana from the islands that could knock a smoker on his ass. Heroin so pure that it was lights out with 1 shot. Long-legged sisters wearing short, glove-tight dresses, and any sort of alcohol, sex, or adventure that could be dreamt up. This was a place that would test the dedication of any innocent, handsome young man. Cassius struggled to get to sleep that first night. He later complained that the worst times of training in Miami were the lonely hours after dark. "I just sit here like a little animal in a box at night," he told a sports writer in 1961. "I can't go out in the street and mix with the folks out there, 'cause they wouldn't be out there if they was up to any good. I can't do nothing except sit. Here I am, just 19, surrounded by showgirls, whiskey, and sissies, and nobody watching me. All this temptation and me trying to train to be a boxer. It's something to think about." The next morning, Clay made his way to the 5th Street gym, where Dundee trained his fighters. In the glory days of prize fighting, 4 training gymnasiums stood above all the others: Gleason's and Stillman's in New York, the Main Street Gym in Los Angeles, and the 5th Street Gym in Miami. Located in South Beach, at the corner of 5th Street and Washington Avenue, it was in a neighborhood where nothing good was happening. Increasingly, the money and development were flowing into North Beach, leaving whole sections of South Beach for the derelicts and the druggies. The dilapidated second-story facility featured rotten floors, cracked mirrors, accumulated grime, and the stench of sweat, jock straps, and cigarette and cigar smoke. In addition to its foul smell and crusted dirt, the gym suffered from other maladies: clogged drains in the showers, holes in the plasterboard walls, and chipping paint lent a certain grungy charm to the place, but an infestation of hungry termites threatened the entire structure. They attacked floors, walls, rings, and even chairs and desks. Possibly they were angered or encouraged by the heat. Hot and sweltering under its tin roof, fighters training in the gym soon realized that the place had no air conditioning, and large floor-to-ceiling windows added to everyone's discomfort. Many of the best fighters who trained there were from Cuba and accustomed to such temperatures, but boxers from the north considered the conditions inside the gym inhumane, if not entirely illegal. But to Angelo Dundee, the place was my little slice of heaven. For the fighters, the gym offered not so much a slice of heaven as the chance for salvation. With the windows open, the hot and stale air from the inside mixed with the humid blasts from the outside, and the noise of the streets harmonized with the sounds of the gym. Men skipping ropes, punching speed bags, heavy bags, and each other, and yelling encouragements and good-natured barbs in English and Spanish. In the Fifth Street gym, white, brown, and black men met in complete equality, fleeing from poverty and even persecution in the pursuit of a dream.
Context of White Supremacy. That will do it for the first audio segment. We'll pick up. We are in Chapter 1, not too far in Chapter 1. We get ready for the second audio segment. Quite a transition from medical apartheid, but I'm looking forward to this book. Always good to read new publications. Again, this just came out in 2016, and I think a good number of our listeners were familiar with this book when it was released a few weeks before Muhammad Ali's transition, but certainly after his death, thought it would be timely to check out this material. Folks who would like to chime in, if you have thoughts, observations, questions, things that stood out from the text, the number to dial is 641-715-3640. The code is 564-943-pound. Press star 6 if you would like to participate. Number again, 641-715-3640. The code is 564-943-pound. Press star 6 if you would like to participate. If you want to join the discussion and you don't want to use your phone, you can use the free VOPE line. It is linked at Black Talk Radio Network. If you need the address, it is tiny.cc/oneRace. And that is the number 1. Address again, tiny.cc/oneRace. And that is the number 1. When you enter that address, look on the left of the page. You'll see the link. It says free VOPE line. Click that link. It will open a small window on your screen. On the first line, it is a drop-down menu. Select the number I just gave, which again is 641-715-3640. Next line, it will ask for the code. That code again is 564-943. Final line, it will ask for a name. You can use your real name. You can use a nickname. If you just want to press random keys, that is fine too. Once you get all that entered, click the green button at the bottom. It will connect you to the live program, and we will be able to get you on the line. It is the same procedure. If you would like to participate, you'll see the dial pad on your screen. Press star 6. When you do so, you will hear an audio prompt. Press the number 1. I'll see your hand on the switchboard. We will add you to the conversation. With that, we will get to the phone lines. If you have questions, things that stood out from the text, observations you would like to share, feel free. Everyone who dialed in with a hand up should be with us.
Greetings. Can I be heard?
Yes, sir.
Yes, looking forward to this book reading, primarily because these two black males, victims of racist white supremacy, who attempted to neutralize white supremacy, are people that they probably out of the two people that I never had a chance to meet personally. Well, I met Muhammad Ali once, but wasn't in their personal life, but always admired them. So it's looking forward to it. But some of the things that I have already, I heard the word divide. And in most times that, and most of the time that I hear that word, it's not constructive, especially towards non-white black people. And it becomes a practice of racism, white supremacy, when a white person used the word divide in reference and or context to a non-white black person. Because non-white black people don't have any power to divide anyone except for other black people as a reaction to the global system of racism, white supremacy, and the mental damage that that system and white people do to us. I don't like the comparison of non-white victims of racist white supremacy, especially by white people. And that appears what the book is going to do. I've heard some clues to it just in that first reading. Dr. Freddie Pacheco, to copy the slang that I hear a lot of young people say, is he's a hater, Dr. Pacheco. I don't think I've heard him speak plenty of times on documentaries, and he never had anything good to say about anything that can be considered to be constructive about non-white black people practicing counter-racism. So just be aware of that. And if one doesn't agree with me, they can check out Dr. Pacheco yourself. Although he was accurate on some things medically that involved Muhammad Ali later on in his boxing career. That leads me to say, give me a reminder of Mr. Fuller says about white people when they're in contact with us as far as how the relationship is: tacky, trashy, and terroristic. So I'm expected that it'll be a lot of tackiness by these white writers in this book. Malcolm X, also according to one source that I read about, also attempted to recruit Jim Brown into the Nation of Islam also. And the time that I heard it was the night that Ali won the title. He didn't go out and hang out. They didn't go out and hang out with a large entourage on the beach. Although Muhammad Ali was invited, but they didn't go. They just hung out in the Overtown area, Brownsville area of Miami down here, in a quiet hotel room. With those individuals coming in and out of the room. Also, Sam Cooke was around, hanging out and around also. The great singer, Sam Cooke, who was also murdered suspiciously. Last but not least, I heard the idea. The writers were admitting of the significant parental warnings that non-white black parents have always had to do with anything concerning white people and white supremacy, whether it's a particular profession, especially law enforcement. That's been going on for a long time. It just didn't happen this week or a couple of weeks ago. But you would think it was by listening to the press recently. And the Colored Town, actually, it had a name that was accepted by black people down here, and that was called, it was called Overtown. And just like a lot of places in this part of the world, they were like the section in Tulsa, it was a thriving area. And as it rose to heights in social, political, and business proficiency, white people destroyed it by building I-95 right through the middle of it. And in turn, what that did, it destroyed home ownership, proficient businesses. By the time Muhammad Ali, as a young Cassius Clay, came down here, it was already in the makings. They were the construction was probably about three quarters finished of the I-95. So it is accurate as far as what they were describing. I can remember it at the same time as a little boy, because my father was a barber, and the trip to get to his barbershop in a place called Liberty City, of all names, we would ride through Overtown. And yes, I've been to Fifth Street Gym several times to watch professional fighters such as Sugar Ray Leonard and Thomas Hearns, to watch them train. All you had to do was pay about $5 and you can see them train, that sort of thing. Anyway, That's what I have on the first reading, and I'll listen to somebody else. Thank you.
Can I be heard?
Yes, sir.
Ah, greetings to you, Gus. Greetings to you, Firefighter in New York. A lot of poignant information that you brought this evening. Thanks for that. When the firefighter talked about the highway being built through the city down there, it made me think. They had a nice cluster of cities listed in the Hidden Color documentary, where they talk about the cities that they didn't bomb or just shoot and kill black people. They would just build highways through them, and they gave a nice list of them, and I believe one of them from Florida was mentioned in the documentary. But one thing the firefighter brought up about white people speaking on non-white people, especially black people, is that in the very beginning, white people in their anti-sexualness, they not only call them brothers, but they also almost describe the relationship as a relationship of lovers. And I found that very telling, because that is white people. They always have to equate any sort of positive relationship between black people as something homosexualized, because that is their culture. And that was just the first thing that stood out with what the firefighter spoke about. And to get into the book on page 13, they wrote, in many ways, Malcolm X and Cassius Clay seemed the product of the same DNA. Both thrived on center stage, surrounded by an audience, standing beneath the spotlight. At Malcolm's pulpit or in Clay's ring, they responded to the thundering sound of applause and the deafening chorus of boos. Neither man could resist the platform, an interview, or debate. Both enjoyed sparring with words and manipulating other men's fears with sensational language. They were both fighters. And what stood out to me in that paragraph was the first line, where they said, in many ways, Malcolm X and Cassius Clay seemed the product of the same DNA. And it just made me think of the FBI's collecting of black male DNA, especially those who end up in greater confinement. And the fact that I'm pretty sure, sounds like even it could have been back then, they were already making comparisons between the genetics of black males that had a counter-racist public, counter-racist activity. So to me, that particular first line stood out for that reason. On the following page, They wrote some really, really important stuff here. He says, but it was never that simple, although their respective biographers have neglected to show that Ali and Malcolm were much more important to one another than previously acknowledged. We have uncovered and interpreted previously unexamined documents that reveal the personal and political dynamics between them. The complex friendship between Malcolm and Ali is interred in a labyrinth jungle of sources. The private papers of Malcolm X, Alex Haley and others, FBI files and surveillance reports, State Department records, archived news footage, and television programs, long unexamined interview transcripts, new interviews with people who knew Ali and Malcolm intimately, the Daily Press, and a variety of other published and unpublished materials. Investigating their relationship, we have reconstructed the lives and movements of Ali and Malcolm, focusing especially on the period from the time they met in June 1962 through February 1965, plotting their daily activities provided a key to deciphering redacted FBI files, revealing the events and conversations recorded in the Bureau's records in a new light. Using these unique sources, we tracked their movements and in the process discovered how historians and biographers have misread the complicated relationship between them. Those two paragraphs really hit home as far as how much scrutiny they were under. Man, the massive amounts of information, down to they said it was a card. I guess it was like a flash card that Muhammad Ali had scribbled on that Alex Haley had held on to. It really makes you think of how much surveillance a lot of us are under and how things that you might scribble on a piece of paper. I remember just going to the studio as an artist and I would write different things or just write little thoughts down and stuff like that. And you just might toss it to the side and not think about it. But, people really pay attention and scrutinize everything. And these two black males were under heavy, heavy, heavy scrutiny. And I just found that to be very telling. And then, wow, on the following page, they write a paragraph that says, when Malcolm's life was in danger, when Elijah Muhammad threatened to cast him outside the Nation of Islam, Clay became the central figure in his world. For the first time, Blood Brothers revealed that the instant Malcolm realized he might be murdered, he tethered his future, his very survival, to the life of a boxer who most people figured would never win the heavyweight championship. Malcolm had no doubt that someone inside the Nation wanted him dead. He also knew that none of Elijah's disciples would risk Clay's life. As long as they were together, Malcolm figured he was safe. Cassius was the perfect shield. However, only 10 days after they celebrated the boxers' championship victory over Sonny Liston, Cassius stopped taking Malcolm's call. Submitting to Elijah, the champ accepted a new name and the Supreme Minister's edict that all Muslims cease contact with Malcolm. Once Muhammad Ali sided with Elijah, Malcolm knew that he could no longer hide behind him. At that moment, he recognized that losing Ali's cover might cost him his life. And this was just very interesting because, to me, if that is accurate, which I think it is to a degree, it just speaks to Malcolm's deep understanding of the way the FBI and these clandestine movements worked, simply because they had already infiltrated the Nation of Islam, and understanding that the relationship between Muhammad Ali and Elijah Muhammad, he probably figured, even with the FBI in the movement, they would be less likely to make a move on him if he was closer to Cassius, to Muhammad Ali. So essentially, even though they had a very deep love of one another, he also understood the dynamics of chess in a way, as far as trying to facilitate his ability to not have himself and other black people get into violent conflict with one another, which is what he really was trying to avoid, I believe. And I just found that very telling, that particular paragraph in which they pointed that information out. Then I believe the firefighter in Florida talked about the legal lynching that Mr. Clay Sr. discussed, and I just thought that entire paragraph where he talks about the legal lynching sounds like exactly what we've been going through for the past couple of weeks and the last 50 years. So I just thought to myself, nothing really changed at that point. And then the final thing I wanted to say was on 23 in the preface, he writes, in a sensational 5-day trial held in a packed courthouse and attended by nationally prominent reporters, Bryant and Malam were tried for kidnapping and murder. After listening to all the evidence, the all-white jury deliberated for 67 minutes before voting to acquit the two men. If we hadn't stopped, this is in the killing of Emmett Till, if we hadn't stopped to drink a pop, commented a juror, it wouldn't have taken that long. And that just really speaks to the psychopathology of white people and the fact that you have a murder of a white young black child by two white men. And it was so easy to acquit them because in the system of white supremacy, we just drink a soda to your dead body and just say, you know, you guys are exonerated. It was, justifiable homicide. And this is the kind of stuff we see today in this way of Dylann Roof being taken out for Burger King, a basically celebratory Burger King sandwich after massacring nine black people. And thank you for taking my call, and I'll meet my line with that.
For sure. Other folks on the line who had comments on the first audio segment, Blood Brothers, they wanted to share. I'll assume perhaps they will save their comments for later. I hope folks will not wait till the last minute if you have comments you would like to share before we get to the second audio segment.
Excuse me, Gus. Can I get one last thing in? Sorry about that. It just came to me as you were saying what you were saying.
Right on.
I do apologize. I sincerely do. I was just thinking, too, with us finishing medical apartheid and transitioning to this book and the allusion that was made to the Parkinson's that he developed, just in the first reading, I absolutely believe that he was given something to facilitate shutting him up permanently. Just from the little bit of what they talked about and some of the discussions that he had publicly back then. So I truly, truly think that he was given some sort of agent of some sort. They might have sprinkled something in his underwear that ended up facilitating his downfall as far as his ability to speak. Thank you. Sorry about that again.
Right on. Let's see. While... if there are other folks who have commentary, we'll nab them as we roll. They'll get a hand up, I presume. We're still pretty early in the book, first section here. Some of the things that stood out, and this is, I guess, a radical shift from the last book, or I guess actually the last two books that we read, both written by black females. This time we have two white males who wrote this book. So I guess the listening skills should be really focused for this one in terms of paying attention to how this information is presented to us. Word choice, if you know we think there could be some acts of racism and how the text is constructed, something that we haven't had to do, I guess, for months now. I think the last time we had a white author was The Half Has Never Been Told, and that was, you know, a while ago. It seems months ago, beginning of the year. At the beginning of the book, this is in the preface, where they are talking about Cassius Clay, and the sentences, or the first two sentences, it says, "At first, Cassius Clay, as he was known until 1964, hid his relationship with Malcolm. A master of deception, he proved infuriatingly elusive for journalists." And just for me, that is a phrase I employ regularly, masters of deception, in talking about whites, racist man, racist woman, and their ability to be deceitful and just to spread lies and false information all the time to keep us confused. That to have that in the preface, that Muhammad Ali is a master of deception, and then to follow that up with this segment from white writer Jack Olson, who's talking about all these different personalities and personas that Ali presented, that stood out to me. Perhaps an act of racism, white supremacy, at minimum, just the type of difference. I don't think it would be very probable that you would have a black author, like if this book had been written by Bill Roden, who wrote $40 Million Slaves, I find it hard to believe that he would say that Muhammad Ali, classify him as a master deceiver, a master of deception. I just find it very hard to believe that a black writer would have constructed a sentence in that way. Incidentally, Jack Olson, I've read some of his material. He's deceased now, but he's also a white male. He wrote Black is Best, which is about black athletes, focuses on Muhammad Ali and some of the other athletes in the 1960s. He wrote a lot of material. He also wrote about Geronimo Pratt, who's in the Black Panther Party, one of the high-ranking members of the Black Panther Party on the West Coast, who was wrongfully, talk about masters of deception, wrongfully imprisoned for nearly 30 years for a crime that he did not commit. COINTELPRO that was just referenced by Roz. He was also one of the victims of the FBI's COINTELPRO activity. They had him under, in fact, they had him under surveillance at the time of the murders that he was convicted for, so they knew he didn't do this and still locked him up for 27 years. He also is deceased. I think he passed away in 2011, but Mr. Olson wrote Last Man Standing, The Tragedy and Triumph of Geronimo Pratt. I actually read that. It does have a lot of information and gives a lot of detail about the COINTELPRO surveillance of Geronimo Pratt and how that was deeply involved in his incarceration. Also has a good bit of information on Johnny Cochran's involvement, years, decades worth of involvement on Geronimo Pratt's case. The next thing that I took note of, when, and again, white writers, this is also in the preface, kind of setting the foundation for the book, as the Louisville Lip, he became the booming athletic equivalent of Little Richard and Elvis Presley, echoing the raucous notes of rock and roll and the television antics of professional wrestler Gorgeous George. Now, again, just in my view with Elvis Presley, and I don't think it's anything that is contested, him stealing, borrowing, imitating, whatever, however you would like to classify it, black musical genius, and being able to make all this money while so many black people suffered and struggled and got nothing for their immense musical abilities. Again, the comparison, that's why I say paying attention to metaphors, analogies, just I think it's really important that they're used, that Muhammad Ali became the equivalent of Elvis Presley. That is an interesting metaphor. Moving forward, and it pops up again, the deception, and again, all of this is in the preface, setting up the foundation for how we're going to proceed with this reading. Only by examining Cassius Clay's early years in Louisville and his relationship with Malcolm X can one hope to discover Muhammad Ali, central to his life, relationships, and career, was deception. That just, to me, sounds like the way I would talk about racist man, racist woman. And even I would say, if he is not presenting himself authentically, why would he, as a black male victim of white supremacy at this time in the 1960s, when you've got black people that are still being killed for anything within this context, why would I? What is the incentive for me at any time, really, even 2016, to present myself authentically to any white person given this environment? There's no reason to. So I just, in my view, I would not clad. I mean, this is hammering it home since it's being repeated this often in the preface. I think there is a much better way that it could be presented, written, if you want to say that this person did not reveal themselves completely to a public being, particularly being a very public figure, and talking to all these white reporters and what have you, did not want to give over themselves, open themselves up completely to just any white person that's going to stick a microphone in your face or say, hey, I'm going to do this interview or put something in the newspaper about you. I think you could craft this in a better way so that we're just not consistently saying that Muhammad Ali was deceptive, and not just deceptive, a massive master deceiver, and that his central defining characteristic of his career and his life is deception. I mean, that is, that's pretty massive in my opinion. And again, I would submit that in likelihood could just be a deliberate act of racism, white supremacy by the co-authors. Let's see, moving forward. Clay possessed the kind of far-reaching cultural power that could unify black people. Recognizing Clay's global fame, Malcolm exploited him, envisioning a new movement that fused together Clay's world and his into one built around celebrity and politics. Again, for me, just word choice is very important. Now, they are using the term white supremacy, which is significant. I think a lot of times we have white authors, when they're talking about white supremacy, they don't use that word. They'll use the word white privilege or some other nonsense, the racial divide, being deceptive, master deceivers with the use of words. I do appreciate that they're using the term white supremacy, but I mean, wow, is that the best way to characterize the relationship between Malcolm X and Cassius Clay? If they had this authentic, genuine relationship, love between them, that Malcolm X exploited Cassius Clay? I would say that. In fact, since that's in the preface, we can keep that in mind as we roll through the book. Is that, you know, what is being conveyed, that Malcolm is exploiting Cassius Clay? That was another one that I noted. And the last note that I had from the preface, we did the preface, the prologue, and a bit of chapter one. That was in the first audio segment today. Actually, that was the last note that I had from the preface. Now moving to the prologue, the said, and I mean, all of this, in my view, I think it's important context. The system of white supremacy contaminates, and one of the primary objectives is to obliterate our ability to have constructive relationships with each other. I think that's one of the main themes of this book. I think that was why a lot of people wanted to read it. That's one of the main themes of probably all of our existence and the work that racists invest in making sure that we do not have quality relationships with other black people. When they were talking about the relationship between Muhammad Ali's mother and father, just extremely sad to hear. And it reminded me of Neely Fuller Jr.'s quote where he said, first time, last time, any putting of hands, black male touching a black female and our frustration, and Lord knows we have lots of it and many justified reasons to be frustrated in a system of white terrorism. But this generally is what happens, where we take out our frustrations on other victims of racism. And first time, last time, this is something that's been going on for generations, and why this is something that we should be passing on to say that's one thing that we're going to do, I think, that would help our counter-racism effort, help us be more productive and try to help produce more quality relationships. We are not going to be taking our anger out on one another. We are not going to continue this pattern of black males abusing black females, and vice versa. You do have black females abusing black males as well, but we're not going to continue that. And first time, last time, just get that established immediately as a part of the foundation of any sort of partnership, any sort of pairing, that we're just not going to continue this legacy. And again, in my view, whites are most to blame for all of this. Next, also, from the prologue, I think Roz did a great job. I think retired firefighter in Florida as well. The speech where the father was talking to the lessons that Cassius Clay Sr. Was telling his children. Don't leave our neighborhood. I think I've seen so many reports this week. In fact, it was Senator Scott in South Carolina. He's a black male. He's one of the few black senators. I think there are only two black senators out of 100 in the United States right now. But he did a piece. There was a piece on him in the Washington Post where all of the events over the past month or so, where he talked about how many times he's been stopped by the police. And this is a U.S. senator, and how humiliating it's been for him. He said he went into the chamber for the Senate, and he had on his pen his identification identifying him as a U.S. senator, and he got stopped by the enforcement officials, like, who are you, where are you going, nigger, you're not supposed to be here. And then he was in his vehicle, and I guess he was going to his residence or wherever he was, and they pulled him over, like, you're in the wrong neighborhood, what are you doing around here, get around. They didn't recognize him as a senator and that sort of thing. But just talking about this quote-unquote wrong neighborhood where Cassius Clay Sr. is selling him, don't leave our neighborhood, don't go into white people's stores, even don't contradict a white man. I thought that one was huge as well, because we've talked about before just not being able to challenge a white person. That even came up a lot when we did medical apartheid, when you're going to talk to these white doctors, white nurses, and you cannot question their authority. You can't ask questions or say that you disagree or what they said is incorrect. That is for sure still in effect 2016, all areas of people activity. But it just puts so much in context when people, I think retired firefighter and Roz both touched on this, people are talking as though the conversation or the talk, I think that's the way that they phrase it now, in terms of preparing black children to deal with white supremacy and enforcement officers and the different terroristic manifestation of whites, as though this is something new. This has been the duration of our existence under white terrorism. This has been the duration of our existence with whites. And in my view, this paragraph right here, everything that Muhammad Ali's father is telling him, this is why you cannot go and talk to a white person at any time and just be, I'm just going to be, as they say, an open book and just lay it all out here. This is why, because I am amongst enemies. You all are just trying to get as much information to terrorize me. That's what the COINTELPRO thing was about. But I thought that was just a really profound paragraph, lessons from his father on so many levels there. Let's see, moving forward in the prologue. And he just made the point where he says every day you're seeing some sort of legal lynching. I thought that was great as well. And really just showing that this is not something, I think often when you have black people who work against racism, white supremacy, I can speak for myself on a personal level because I've had people ask me that question. I think Mr. Malcolm X, they asked him the same question. Dr. King, Rosa Parks, where they try and make it seem like it was just the incident on the bus. Fannie Lou Hamer. Where it will be, oh, you just had this one incident where, you know, they were a little bit rude to you on this day, or it was just this one moment, and that's not what it is at all. I think they had that beautiful exchange from Minister Malcolm where, you know, this reporter was doing the same thing with him. It has been the totality of my existence, even when I didn't realize it. From the moment of conception, I have been terrorized by whites. It's everything. It's not one acute moment where I said, oh man, I'm being terrorized here. I should think about this. So I should try to do something about this. It's the entirety of my existence. And it really just comes down to, you know, recognizing that, being truthful about that, and then figuring out what you can, should be doing to correct that problem. They've been kind of wove in quite a bit of Negro literature, James Baldwin, and they had the quote to begin chapter one, and Langston Hughes, Richard Wright, they referenced Native Son, and one of my top five books, Invisible Man, Ralph Ellison. We've talked about that on the program repeatedly, in fact, Invisible Man. But they're weaving in quite a bit of black literature within this, Alex Haley as well, with Autobiography of Malcolm X also. Let's see, what else did I get? The Emmett Till, I was really glad they included that. I think we're probably going to have many of those moments that will be just like Emmett Till, and those type of signature moments of white terrorism, and just realizing the vulnerability that black lives do not matter. Black children, black elderly people, black fathers, mothers, whatever, your life does not matter. I think we will continue to have those sort of moments that resonate with us over a lifetime, as long as the system of white terrorism exists. Just the surveillance, I think Roz pointed that out. That's something that I think probably gets greatly minimized. That was kind of how I got into studying racism, white supremacy, counter-racism, Mr. Fuller's work, and what have you, was through COINTELPRO, and just studying what the FBI had done, because I didn't hear about any of that stuff until I went to college, and I was stunned because I'd never heard anybody talk about that. I'd heard people talk about the civil rights movement, but I just had no idea that there was this much surveillance and manipulation and lying and, you know, these secret plans to kill people. I had no idea. And the more I studied Julian Bond's class, God Bless the Dead, and obviously he was another one that was attacked, and under all this, I just don't think you can grasp the magnitude, the impact, when you have one of the most powerful enforcement agencies in the world, where they're almost operating with an unlimited budget, where they can pay people, multiple people, to just study and follow you, and collect a whole dossier on your life, and go back through your childhood records, your school records, talk to people that know you, go through your mail, listen to your phone calls, pay attention to all your habits, go through your trash. I mean, I just don't think you can grasp the magnitude of the type of impact that that can have on you. It's not like people are just doing this because they like you or they think you're cool. These are your enemies who are doing this with the total intent of absolutely destroying and neutralizing you. Now, to have that, and to have two people who probably have probably some of the thickest
files in the COINTELPRO records. I would submit, I doubt there are very many people, black people, who have a thicker file in the COINTELPRO records. Maybe Dr. King, maybe. But I would submit Minister Malcolm X, Muhammad Ali is probably not two black people of that era who have more paper on them in terms of their activities, what they were doing, what they were talking about, who they were hanging around with. And they're together? Like, oh my God. Like, that would, just in my view, that would have to represent a catastrophic threat in the system of white supremacy. If these folks are hanging out and friends, and he's going to be hanging out at, I mean, if you can even imagine if Minister Malcolm had not been assassinated in 1965 with the magnitude of the Ali Frazier fights, the George Foreman fights, everything that happened down the road in Muhammad Ali's career, Malcolm X is in his corner? Oh, my Lord. Like, I cannot even fathom how that would evolve. But I mean, just the pressure that these people were under in trying to just live their lives, much less their careers and everything else that they were trying to do in fighting against racism. It's difficult to even fathom or quantify and how that would play out in their relationships with each other and with other people in their lives. It's almost incomprehensible to evaluate the ways that racist white supremacists are working against us. In fact, I can conclude it here. From the last book that we read, when people talk about racism in the healthcare industry and all of the information that she presented Harriet A. Washington for centuries, and how many black people do not know all of that information about how this has continued for years. This is way beyond Tuskegee. I just don't think if you look at that and then COINTELPRO and all the other manifestations of how they are at total war with us in all areas of people activity, it is almost difficult to comprehend, one, what they're doing, and then how to go about getting a response given the multiple war fronts that they are on against us. It is mind-boggling at times the amount of energy that they invest in terrorizing black people and all of this, again, to maintain eternal domination, white supremacy, over black people, non-white people worldwide. I will stop there. I see that other folks dialed in who have hands up. If we have not heard from you and you have comments you would like to share, feel free. Your line should be open.
May I be heard?
Yes, ma'am. Go ahead.
I just wanted to just share basically what you were saying. Reading this, the beginning of this, it just definitely shed light on the surveillance that they put under these, Minister Malcolm and Muhammad Ali. And I was just blown away because they even tell on themselves, you know. It's like, I don't know what page this is on, but I have the Kindle version. And there was a part in the book where he says, the complex friendship between Malcolm and Ali is interred. No, that's not the part. I'm sorry. Okay, they said, investigating their relationship, we have reconstructed the lives and movements of Ali and Malcolm, focusing on, especially on, the period of time they met in June 1962 through February 1965. Plotting their daily activities provided a key to deciphering redacted FBI files, revealing the events and conversations recorded in the Bureau's records in a new light. Using these unique sources, we tracked their movements and in the process discovered how historians and biographers have misread the complicated relationship between them. And when I read this part, I'm just thinking, like, okay, after their death, they're still going through the files. They're still trying to decipher, redacted FBI files. They're still trying to piece together their everyday movements. It's like they do not stop studying us. And it's mind-boggling. One thing I appreciate Mr. Fuller always stressing is to find the mistakes that, like, what's the purpose of studying history if we're not looking for the mistakes? And I think that now that I'm striving to be less confused, when I read these books or anytime I'm reading or just studying our history, I mean, now I'm looking at, okay, where did we make the mistake? Like, you know, how can we not, you know, do the same things over and over again, I guess, you know, expecting a different result. And now that I have a different, you know, just outlook, it's just, it's interesting because they don't stop studying us. And it's unbelievable. Like you said, it was just, you know, what you said, you know, the energy and time and the resources. They're still putting books out, trying to figure out these two individuals. And, you know, it's just so important for us to do the same thing, but to find the mistake. So I'm excited about reading this book to just get a better understanding and to read with a different type of eye, if that makes sense. So I just wanted to add that, and I'll mute my line.
Right on. Thomas in New York, did you have comments, sir?
Absolutely. You know, what she just said was right on point. What you were saying about the study, and I definitely want to point out, I could definitely tell these are white authors from listening to the audio, just the, like you said, a lot of the terms they use, just the way they write about it. And I also say, I commend, I believe it was Ali's father for giving. How much has that speech changed over the years? It hasn't changed much. You know, that speech you give to your son, you know, I don't think it's changed too much over the years. And I just wanted, what I really wanted to chime in and say for this first part is every book that we start reading, it has like a correlation. It's like, it's almost like it's meant to be read. Now here we spoke about it yesterday, all of the basketball players, some of the basketball players standing up, and now we're doing a book where they're talking about, you know, the athletes, you know, back then that kind of did it. So I just thought that was very good how they kind of correlated right into what's going on. And I'll meet my line for now. Thank you.
Timing is pretty good here on the context of white supremacy. The person from a block number, did you have a commentary you wanted to get in?
Just listening.
Oh, right on. We get everybody who had commentary that they wanted to share. Did we miss anybody? Anybody who dialed in with a hand up who has not been able to share at all?
May I be heard?
Yes, ma'am.
All right. Caller from 712. Hello, everyone on the line. And Gus, hello. The notes that I took from it was, the first note I took was the master of deception when they used that. And I shook my head. I said, here we go. I said, really, Muhammad Ali, a master of deception? They used a word, chicanery. I think it went, Muhammad Ali's trainer was willing to do any type of chicanery to get something done, and I'm going to have to look that word up. I don't even know if I spelled it right. Sounds like sugar cane just mixed together with the chicanery at the end. I don't know. I have to look it up. And wherever they were training at when they were describing it in the beginning, it sounded like it was, if it wasn't hell, it was the lobby. But the trainer said it was, I believe it was the trainer, he said it was his slice of heaven. And then that made me believe that trainer probably was somebody who classifies himself as white. I also got that Alex Haley, I put Alex Haley lied, but I don't know if he lied, but they said he did something trying to sensationalize the book, the autobiography book. And so I've heard that before about Alex Haley not being honest about stuff, like I guess Roots was, something was going on with that. And I took a note about the word exploit. He said that Malcolm X was exploiting Muhammad Ali. And again, I had to shake my head. I said, I don't know about that. said that Ali was a shield for Malcolm X, like a shield of protection. Took note of that. Ali's father was an abusive person. Ali's father taught his children about racism early when they were children. Took those two notes and also took the note about names, how really white people don't want to call you the name that you want to be called. It said Malik El Shabazz will always be known as Malcolm X or be lovingly known as Malcolm X or something, they said, to that effect. So I don't have the copy of the book. I'm going to see if they have it at the library, but those are the notes that I took. And thank you so much.
For sure. Chicanery, the word that you had mentioned, that's, I can, that is one reason I do enjoy having the electronic version of these, because it's really easy to look up words as you go. You can just double click and boop, it'll give you the definition if you have the Kindle or if you have the ebook version. But chicanery, the use of trickery to achieve a political, financial, or legal purpose. And then the sentence that they give, an underhanded person who schemes corruption and political chicanery behind closed doors. Chicanery. I think that was the word you were referencing. In fact, just so we can go back so we have it in context, where it was read, fiercely loyal to his fighters and capable of all sorts of chicanery in pursuit of victory, he was in all ways a gentleman, gracious, and this is talking about Dundee, Angelo Dundee, capable of all sorts of chicanery in the pursuits of victory. He was in all other ways a gentle, gracious man who sought nothing more than tranquility. Did anybody else have anything they wanted to get in before we get to audio segment number two? Anything else?
Yeah, I just...
I'm sorry, I was just going to say, are you not getting like a homoerotic vibe in the way it's being written?
I was definitely thinking that when she mentioned about Angelo Dundee saying being at the gym was like his slice of heaven, talking about these. It almost reminded me of Donald Sterling before he got in trouble. They had made this report that he would enjoy going and seeing the black males for the Clippers being in the shower and just like, oh, it just looks so great. All of these naked black bodies. Like it definitely the way just the descriptions, like I said, even specifically the way it was talking about Angelo D and him loving being in this gym. Like that was a thought that came to me.
Yeah, I just wanted to.
Go ahead, sir.
Oh, I just wanted to add on, during the time when the young Cassius Clay first came to South Florida, the transition was being made, and I think it was, for the most part, the white people who practiced Judaism were buying out the older white, and they were called crackers at that time, buying out, you know, Miami Beach at that time. And it still was very heavy restriction. I forgot that metaphor that was popular during that time I think it's sundown town. Well, Miami Beach was a sundown town for non-white black people during that time. Even a short time before, you had to have a, which I guess would effectively be called a passport as a black person to be able to go over to Miami Beach. It was separated from the quote-unquote greater Miami area by water, and the only way you can get over there was going through a narrow series of roads, so that was the atmosphere, you know, at that particular time. And of course, a young Cassius Clay had that passport and everything already arranged for him because he was a fighter that was basically financed by some wealthy white males in Kentucky who already had made those type of arrangements for him. It was something else. It was something else that I was thinking about. Oh, it just slipped my mind. Should have wrote it down. Anyway, when I think about it, I'll bring it up maybe during the next time. Thank you.
Last comment.
Yes, I was just going to say, I remembered in the beginning of my comments, I was trying to find a line while the firefighter was speaking just now, but they had actually, I said it earlier, they kind of even made a homosexual allusion in between the relationship between Minister Malcolm and Muhammad Ali in the very beginning as well. They said that they had, of course, the deep brotherly type of affection for each other, but they also compared them to lovers as well, which I just thought was very Greek and Roman and anti-sexual and racist white supremacist. So, yeah, definitely there's a homosexual undertone to what they're talking about from many different angles, actually, with the information that both you and Thomas in New York pointed out. Thank you.
Right on. If you have more commentary, if you forgot, retired firefighter, I'm sure it'll come to you. Just make a note, and
I remembered. I remembered on what I wanted to say, and it's relevant to this part, this first part, on why a young Cassius Clay was coy. They use the term deceptive, deception, or something like that. He was locally in Kentucky, during that time with sports, as a black male, there was very few black males that could have made the transition to Division I football to the NFL. There were very few black males who could make the transition to the major leagues in baseball. There was a very few black males who could make the transition to Division I basketball and to the NBA. Boxing was still a common practice of choice with sports. Cassius Clay just happened to be one of the best at the time. People were investing into him. Financially, as I mentioned, those white males in Kentucky, and he stood to also benefit financially. So he wasn't stupid. He wasn't going to bring out in the open his relationship with the Nation of Islam. He had been going to New York through boxing tournaments, and because his father, as we read, had already was coaching him on the rules of racism as a parent. That was his level of teaching his son. But when he went to places like New York and Chicago, and he would hear people from the various personalities from the Nation of Islam, they appeared to him to be much more vast and understanding on what the system of racism white supremacy is and how it works. And that's what attracted him.
We will leave it there. If you want to add more, we should have time during the second audio segment. We are picking up in chapter one, early part of chapter one, Blood Brothers, on the friendship between Muhammad Ali and Malcolm X. This is audio segment number two, Context of White Supremacy.
Some of the finest boxers of the early 1960s trained alongside Clay under Angelo's guidance. In 1961, the revolutionary government of Fidel Castro outlawed professional boxing in Cuba, sending dozens of skillful Cuban boxers into exile in the United States, and especially Miami, where they added to Dundee's pool of talent. Willie Pastrano won the light heavyweight championship in 1963, the same year that Ralph Dupaz captured the junior middleweight title, Ultiminio Sugar Ramos the featherweight crown, and Luis Rodriguez the welterweight belt. Every week, it seemed, Angelo and one of his contenders headed to some world capital for an important match. It was a heady time, with talk of big-money title fights and the smell of success cutting through the malodorous, low-rent atmosphere of the Fifth Street gym. But at the center of the action was young Cassius, just beginning his professional career and fighting in small-money preliminary matches, but with an ego and energy that filled the gym. Observing the action inside the facility, sports writer Myron Cope wrote, "Cassius reigns over the gym's white, Negro, and Cuban fighters like the leader of a street gang who has established his authority merely by talking his subjects into submission. He jabbers away at the Cubans in homemade simulated Spanish, and they throw up their hands and walk away, shouting, 'Niño con boca grande,' the baby has a big mouth." There was no resentment in the comment, just a statement of fact. In Cassius's case, trainer and fighter were ideally matched. Dundee saw immediately that by the standards of classic boxing, Clay was a deeply flawed fighter. He kept his hands too low, often avoided punches by moving straight back, and was a dyed-in-the-wool headhunter. He did not even faintly resemble Joe Lewis or Sonny Liston, hard-punching heavyweights with wonderful balance, great left jabs, and knockout power in both hands. But for all his deficiencies, Cassius had assets. Most obviously, he had extraordinary hand and foot speed. When he arrived in Miami, he was a small heavyweight, weighing only 182 pounds, but his quickness was more than just the result of size. Probably no heavyweight had ever been as fast as Clay, certainly none in the early 1960s, when most, with the exception of Floyd Patterson, tended to be orthodox plodders. Less readily apparent, Clay's sense of distance was nearly perfect. This ability is crucial in boxing. Throw a punch from too far away, and it falls short of its target. Throw it too close, and it loses its full leverage. In addition, a fighter who moves too close to an opponent is easier to tie up. Clay's speed allowed him to dart in and out. His sense of distance permitted him to throw a punch at the ideal moment when it could reach its target with maximum force. Almost no fighter could snap out a jab as quickly or accurately as Clay, and none could deliver a faster right-hand lead. Furthermore, his quickness and sense of distance allowed him to dodge his opponent's punches, sometimes by mere inches. Many trainers would have winced at Clay's glaring flaws and attempted to teach him proper technique. Dundee, however, focused on Cassius's magnificent assets. To be sure, he tried to refine Clay's unorthodox style, smoothing his herky-jerky movements. He worked on his balance, convincing him to throw more flat-footed power punches, and advised him to get his weight behind his blows. But crucially, Angelo did not seek to fundamentally change Cassius's style. He believed that every fighter was unique and should be treated that way. "There's not two alike," he noted. "You don't say, 'This guy fights like this guy.' They don't. They're all individuals. They all got their own idiosyncrasies, got their own rhythm." Much as Cassius may have imagined himself as another Sugar Ray Robinson, Dundee's primary job was to train Cassius Clay to box like Cassius Clay. After listening to Clay talk and watching him spar, Dundee told his fighter, "You, my friend, are neither Sugar Ray Robinson nor Archie Moore, and you've got a long way to go before you will even resemble them. Who you are is Cassius Marcellus Clay, Jr., and that's the man I'm going to teach you to fight like. A guy is never going to get anywhere thinking he's somebody else." Angelo quickly realized that, for all his bluster, Cassius was a dedicated athlete. He came to the gym on time, trained tirelessly, and learned quickly, as long as the lessons were packaged correctly. Dundee seldom told Clay what to do. Rather, he made Cassius feel like he was the source of every improvement. "I didn't train him," Dundee recalled. "I advised him. He'd be in the gym and I'd say, 'You're really putting your left hand into that jab. You're really snapping it.' Then, when I'd see him doing something right again, I'd say, 'Oh my God, I've never seen a heavyweight throw a left uppercut so perfectly. Oh boy.' Then he'd throw it again and again." Confronted with Clay's ego, Dundee discarded his own, becoming the ideal second banana.
If Cassius said, "I'm going to run 5 miles," Angelo responded, "That's good for your legs." If Clay changed his mind and said, "No, I'm going to rest," Dundee instantly added, "Good, you need your rest." This way, the fighter was in charge, even when he was not really in charge. On the one critical aspect of the pace of Clay's career, Dundee had the final word. Clay repeatedly told reporters that he wanted to break Floyd Patterson's record as the youngest heavyweight champion of all time, 21 years and 10 months, which meant that he had to capture the title by December 12, 1963. But that was Cassius's obsession, not Angelo's, who was more concerned with advancing his fighter cautiously. He had seen too many fighters pressured into a mismatch. For the first few years, at least, Dundee would only take sure-bet contests for Clay, matches that he could win on his worst day. In the language of the fight game, Angelo arranged for Cassius to box opponents, men who had virtually no hope of reaching contender status, or one-time contenders on a steep slide down the rankings. Beginning in the last week of 1960, Cassius began to fight a string of setups. The fights were not fixed, but it would have taken a virtual act of God for him to lose. Herb Seiler was a drunk who had no boxing talent. Clay took him out in the fourth. Anthony Big Tony Asperti had just gotten out of the can on an unlawful entry conviction and was in no condition to fight. Cassius ended the match in the third. Sweet Jimmy Robinson had a razor cut on his cheek and no business in a prize ring. The referee stopped the fight halfway through the first. In just over a month in Miami, Cassius had improved his record to 4-0. Still, matches against setups were little help when it came to persuading boxing fans to accept Clay's claim that he was a great fighter. For now, what happened in a sparring match was more important. In February 1961, a handsome Swedish heavyweight and former world champion, Ingemar Johansson, came to Miami to train for his upcoming title fight with Floyd Patterson. Needing sparring partners, the Johansson camp told promotional coordinator Harold Conrad to hire a few. Conrad went to the Fifth Street gym and asked Dundee for recommendations. Calling Clay over, Dundee said, "Hey Cash, you want to work with Johansson?" The question was a switch, lighting up Clay. "I'll go dancing with Johansson," he said, repeating, "I'll go dancing with Johansson." Conrad just looked at Angelo. "You ain't seen nothing yet with this crazy bastard," Conrad recalled Dundee saying. And he hadn't. "Johansson had a great right hand, but two left feet," Conrad said. Once the former champion and the preliminary fighter were in the ring together, in front of sports writers and 2,000 spectators, Cassius literally danced circles around Ingemar, hitting him with light jabs as if we were fighting a rematch with Big Tony. "Cassius Clay, 19, advanced on Ingemar Johansson," wrote the Miami Herald's John Underwood. Whap! His jab bounced off the Swede's headpiece. Whap, whap! Two more jabs. Clay danced lightly, shifted feet, led with the right. Zing, frap, whap! The combination explored the celebrated Johansson profile above and around the dimpled chin. And so it continued, Johansson, a miffed lumbering bear, chasing the bee who had stung him. Talking while he moved, Clay exhorted, "I'm the one who should be fighting Patterson, not you. Come on, here I am. Come on and get me, sucker. Come on. What's the matter? Can't hit me?" It was like Jack Johnson fighting Tommy Burns, like Clay was the champion, and Johansson the trail horse. Johansson was furious, Conrad recalled. I mean, he was pissed. He chased Clay around the ring, throwing amateurish punches, missing by feet, and looking, at last, ridiculous. After 2 rounds, he was exhausted, and the session was stopped. "He made a monkey out of Johansson," remembered Sports Illustrated writer Gil Rogan. When he returned to New York, he told the editors at the magazine, "This guy is going to be heavyweight champion someday. You have to write about him." For Rogan, Underwood, and other sports writers, this was Clay's true Olympian moment. They recognized the emergence of a star. The Johansson session showed Dundee that it was time to match him against more experienced boxers. Clay stopped Donnie Fleeman, a good club fighter, in the seventh round. Then he fought Lamar Clark, who possessed a gaudy 46-2 record that included a streak of 44 straight knockouts. Against Clay, however, the heavy-punching Clark was outmatched. Cassius took him out in the second round. Marv Jensen, Clark's manager, was impressed. "This guy isn't very many fights away from a championship, as far as I'm concerned," Jensen said. "He has the fastest hands of any heavyweight I've seen any place, including Patterson." Black sports writers were even more generous. Evoking the near-sacred L word, a Pittsburgh Courier scribe compared Clay favorably with the legendary Joe Louis. And for the first time in his professional career, New York Times feature writer Arthur Daly devoted a Sports of the Times column to Clay, describing him as a compulsive talker with the engaging personality of a youthful Archie Moore. Daly wrote, "This good-looking boy is a charmer and is so natural that even his more extravagant statements sound like exuberance instead of braggadocio. On him, they look good." With comparisons to Lewis and notice in the New York Times, Clay's career was bounding forward ahead of schedule. After a month's vacation in Louisville and road trips to visit Wilma Rudolph and other friends from the Olympics, in the late spring of 1961, he once again boarded the South Wind for Miami, where Dundee waited to resume his education. And that was fine with the fighter, who viewed any gym as safe territory, an oasis away from the nation's racial problems and the traps and temptations that waited around every corner of the urban South. "It's either get rich in 3 hours or get poor in 8, he liked to say. "Train hard for 3 hours, or 4 or 5, or get a manual day job for pennies an hour." He had chosen the path to wealth and applied himself totally. And the Louisville sponsoring group made sure that, unlike most other fighters, Cassius did not have to get a job to make ends meet. Train and dream, dream and train, from busy days at the Fifth Street Gym to lonely nights at the Charles Hotel. These formed the physical and emotional parameters of his life in Miami. Boxing, however, could not satisfy his spiritual life. There was no avoiding the world outside his hotel and the boxing arena. After all, Cassius was in the South, the land of Emmett Till's murder and his father's gruesome tales. Since he did not own a car, he jogged more than 5 miles from his hotel to the gym at the south end of Miami Beach. He ran in blue jeans and old military boots. As he crossed the Julia Tuttle Causeway, with the Miami skyline in the distance and a cool breeze blowing across the bay, Clay shadowboxed. It was a strange sight to the white policeman who thought that a black man running across the highway, furiously punching the air, must be crazy or a thief, or both. In Miami, police frequently harassed blacks on the streets and raided black pool halls and bars. The officer stopped Clay to question him. Sweating and excited, Clay explained that he was running to Angelo Dundee's gym. The police then called Dundee to verify his story. The trainer explained that the kid was his boxer. "That's Cassius Clay," he said. The episode offered an important lesson for Clay. White policemen didn't know his name and didn't care to know it. To them, he was just another Negro living across the tracks in the colored district of Overtown. After Clay returned to Miami from his visit home, Dundee upgraded him from the low-rent living quarters at the Charles Hotel to the Sir John Hotel on Little Broadway, a vibrant strip of nightclubs, theaters, diners, and shops. Some of the most famous black entertainers and athletes in America stayed at the Sir John Hotel and the Mary Elizabeth Hotel, including Ella Fitzgerald, Duke Ellington, Louis Armstrong, Nat King Cole, Sammy Davis Jr., and Sugar Ray Robinson. These celebrities did not choose to stay at the Sir John or the Mary Elizabeth because these establishments offered the finest accommodations. They had little choice. Blacks could not enter the best downtown hotels unless they waited tables, prepared meals, scoured toilets, or hauled white people's bags. Not even Joe Louis could check into the Fountain Blue Hotel on Miami Beach. Since the early 20th century, real estate developers had promoted Miami as the Magic City. Beautiful beaches, luxurious resorts, and exotic entertainment attracted wealthy investors, tourists, and dreamers. But the city's black citizens were barred from the beaches, restaurants, golf courses, schools, and theaters of Miami's tropical paradise. In 1959, civil rights activists defied white supremacists, sponsoring dozens of sit-ins at department stores, drugstores, and diners. By August 1960, just before Clay arrived, their persistence and shrewd backroom negotiations with white leaders had led to the complete desegregation of the city's downtown. Yet Clay quickly learned that the city's culture of racism remained intact. In August 1961, Flip Schulke, a white photographer from Sports Illustrated, visited Miami for a photo shoot with Clay. Schulke was a serious photojournalist who had traveled the world and taken memorable photos that appeared in leading American publications, but he had never photographed a boxer. Shopping at Burdine's department store, Clay picked up a short-sleeved shirt while Schulke snapped pictures. When a white store clerk saw the tall, lean black man touching the shirts, he informed him that store policy prohibited blacks from trying on clothing. Schulke fumed. It shocked him that Cassius Clay, an Olympic champion, could not try on a shirt in an American store. But Clay was not surprised. He wasn't even angry. This was the South. As a Southerner, he outwardly accepted second-class citizenship as a way of life. "Come on, Flip, don't worry about it," he said. "I don't want to make a big mess here. It's not a big deal." Clay may have been a boxer, but he was not a fighter. He disliked confrontations and avoided violence outside the ring. He preferred Overtown, where he felt safer among his own people. Throughout the neighborhood, blacks greeted him warmly and made him feel important. And soon enough, one man in particular, standing at the corner of Northwest 2nd Avenue and 6th Street, in front of Muhammad's Temple of Islam, caught Cassius's attention. Sam Saxon, a burly 30-year-old light-skinned black man with the arms of a blacksmith, waved a copy of Muhammad Speaks, the Nation of Islam's newspaper. The two men started talking about the teachings of Elijah Muhammad. As he listened to Clay speak, it was clear to Saxon that he had already heard of the nation's leader, though he had never seen or met Elijah before. "Hey, you're into the teaching," Saxon said. "Well, I ain't been to the temple, but I know what you're talking about," Clay replied. Then the boxer introduced himself as he always did. "I'm Cassius Clay. I'm going to be the next heavyweight champion of the world." Saxon, a boxing fan, recognized the name. "I know you, man," he said. "I followed you in the Olympics." The fact that Saxon knew his name engendered a level of trust from Clay. A former gambler and poolroom hustler turned missionary, Saxon had become a devout Muslim. When he was not selling copies of Muhammad Speaks or teaching in the temple, he ran concessions at the Miami racetracks and worked as a bathroom attendant, handing towels to white men and shining their shoes. But his primary objective in life, his real love, was fishing for converts. Wherever there were large concentrations of so-called Negroes, as the black Muslims called them, those lost souls in the kingdom of Allah, Elijah Muhammad's ministers cast their lines. On Sundays, young Muslim men, clean-shaven and hair close-cropped, dressed in dark suits, waited outside churches, inviting Christians to hear the truth about God at the local temple. On weeknights, Muhammad's foot soldiers, armed with Muslim literature, canvassed the streets of the ghetto, fishing for the dead, those deaf, dumb, and blind, brainwashed of all self-respect and knowledge of kind by the white slave master. In nearly every large American city, Muslim officers trolled in bars, liquor stores, pool halls, barber shops, and diners. Standing on soapboxes and stepladders, Muhammad's articulate followers preached, captivating the curious. In their meetings at Temple No. 29, a vacant storefront converted into a makeshift mosque, Saxon noticed that Clay was curious about the Muslim faith. In Miami, most blacks viewed the Muslims with skepticism, rarely entering the temple. When Clay first started attending meetings, there were only about 30 members. In his first visit, he heard a preacher named Brother John deliver a sermon on the history of the black man. Cassius learned that white slave owners stripped the black man of his identity, his heritage, his language, and his true name, and replaced it with a slave name, a name that belonged to the white man. According to the Muslims, the word Negro derived not from the Latin niger, meaning black, but rather from the Greek nekros, meaning corpse. Thus, the man who called himself a Negro remained spiritually dead, buried in the grave. Brother John's sermon helped Cassius make sense of his family's history and his own identity as a black man. He later recalled, "I could reach out and touch what Brother John was saying. It wasn't like church teaching, where I had to have faith that what the preacher was preaching was right. And I said to myself, Cassius Marcellus Clay, he was a Kentucky white man who owned my great-granddaddy and named my great-granddaddy after him. And then my granddaddy got named, and then my daddy, and now it's me." For the first time in his life, Clay's name didn't sound so magical. At that moment, when Cassius began questioning the origins of his name, Sam Saxon knew that he had hooked a big fish. Depending on the day of the week and the whim of the moment, Cassius claimed to have first learned about the Nation of Islam in Atlanta, Chicago, or New York in 1958, 1959, or 1960. Over the years, whenever reporters asked him about his conversion to Islam, his answers were inconsistent. In his stories, Clay created an origin myth based on his scattered memories and affection for tall tales. There were hardly any witnesses who could testify about his accounts, creating a sense of mystery about his activities with the nation. In all of his anecdotes about meeting the Muslims, one thing remained constant. Whenever he left Louisville and found freedom from supervision, he gravitated toward the temples. No one understood this better than Clay's own mother. "The big mistake was when the Louisville sponsoring group sent him to train at Miami all by himself," she said. "That's when the Muslims got him. That's how Sam Saxon got him and talked that Muslim stuff to him every day." Odessa was unaware that her son had started listening to the Muslims long before he ever met Sam Saxon. As a teenager, when Cassius traveled for amateur boxing tournaments, he came across Muslim preachers proselytizing for the teachings of Elijah Muhammad. In October 1958, Clay and his brother Rudy traveled to Atlanta for a vacation. At the time, the FBI had assigned Special Agent Robert R. Nichols to investigate the activities at Muhammad's Temple No. 15 in Atlanta. Nichols set up wiretaps on the temple's phones and hired college students to record the minister's speeches. Nichols learned that Clay had talked with the Muslims outside the Atlanta Temple on Piedmont Avenue. At the time, the information seemed unimportant. After all, Cassius was just a 16-year-old kid from Louisville. Yet that day in Atlanta marked the beginning of his indoctrination. "That was the moment," he said, "I was fished off a street corner." When he traveled to Chicago for the Golden Gloves tournament in March 1959, he once again ran into the Muslims outside their temple. Near the nation's headquarters, the Muslims gave Clay a record that they said would explain everything he needed to know. When he returned to Louisville, he played the record repeatedly. Performing "A White Man's Heaven is a Black Man's Hell," Louis Eugene Wolcott, a charming and talented calypso singer, crooned over piano and guitar. Wolcott, who was then known as Louis X and would later become recognized as Louis Farrakhan, became so popular singing the song at the nation's rallies that it became the anthem of the Muslim movement. Clay played the record over and over, memorizing the lyrics and absorbing the message. In Miami, Sam Saxon and the other members of the mosque echoed the song's central theme, reminding him that there was no heaven or hell after death. While the black man lived in hell, they said, white Christians enjoyed heaven on earth. For a young man who dreamed of riches, Cadillacs, and mansions, the lyrics made him question his Baptist upbringing. As early as 1961, he began talking about what he had learned from the Muslims, though he was careful to ensure that not even the sharpest reporter could recognize that he was sharing what the Muslims had taught him. When Clay started telling Sports Illustrated's Houston Horn what he thought about heaven and hell, the writer had no idea that the boxer's interpretation of the afterlife came directly from the black Muslims. "Like last Sunday," he said, "some cats I know said, 'Cassius, Cassius, come on now and let's go to church. Otherwise you won't get to heaven.' 'Hold on a minute,' I said to them, 'and let me tell you something else. When I've got me $100,000 house, another $250,000 stuck in the bank, and the world title latched onto my name, then I'll be in heaven. Walking around making $25 a week with 4 children crying at home 'cause they're hungry? That's my idea of hell.'" Clay already knew from experience that merely talking about the Muslims could jeopardize his future. During his senior year of high school, he had written a paper about the nation for his English class. At night, he and his brother Rudy sometimes listened to Elijah Muhammad's national radio address. On the streets of Louisville, Cassius noticed black men dressed in dark suits, similar to the men he had seen in Atlanta and Chicago, selling copies of Muhammad Speaks. Yet when he wrote his paper, his teacher was so alarmed that she threatened to fail him, though the principal ultimately overruled her. Clay continued his education about the nation in Miami. His most important teacher was Ishmael Sabakan, minister of the local temple. Nearly once a week, he visited with his spiritual mentor. At their meetings, he listened more than he talked. Sabakan taught him the basic tenets of the nation, an esoteric religious movement fabricated from black nationalism, Christianity, Islam, and cosmology. He explained that God was a black man, a real man on earth, and that the devil was a white man, who also inhabited the earth. Blacks and whites must separate, because there could be no peace between God and the devil. The Muslims' views about God and the devil, heaven and hell, helped Cassius understand the cruel world his father had described. Clay Sr. had told him how whites had segregated, abused, and tortured his people, and the history lessons Cassius learned from the Muslims offered further proof of the white man's wicked ways. The devil, they said, had kidnapped, shackled, and enslaved his ancestors. When the slaves arrived from Africa, whites forced them to abandon their native culture. Being black, the whites preached, was a curse. They convinced the slaves to hate everything that was black, including themselves. The devil imposed Christianity onto their slaves, manipulating them into worshiping the white man and the white man's God, a God having the same blonde hair, pale skin, and blue eyes as the slave master. It all made sense to Cassius. Growing up, he never understood why everything associated with blackness was considered bad. "When I was a little kid, I always knew something was wrong," he said. "Everything good was supposed to be white. And I'd ask my mom, 'Why is Santa Claus white? Why is Jesus white?'" He continued, "Miss America was white. The good cowboy always rode on a white horse. Angel food cake is white, and devil's food cake is black. Even the president lived in a white house." Listening to Muhammad's radio addresses, Cassius heard something that he had never heard before, a message that he would begin repeating over the course of his career. Blacks were the strongest, most intelligent people in the world. The black man, Muhammad proclaimed, was the greatest. The black people in America have for many years been made to feel that they were something of a divine curse, he preached. You must not think that about yourself anymore. We, the black nation of the earth, are the number one owners of it, the best of all human beings. You are the most powerful, the most beautiful, and the wisest. The son of a poor sharecropper turned Baptist preacher, Elijah Poole was born in 1897 in South Central Georgia. Raised on his father's fiery sermons, he became enraptured with Scripture, though he struggled to read the Bible after dropping out of school around the fourth grade. Laboring on farms, at a sawmill, and as a bricklayer, he matured into a frustrated young man, disillusioned by meager wages, harsh employers, and the humiliation of Jim Crow. Seeking relief from discrimination and poverty, in 1923, Elijah followed the Great Migration north, settling in Detroit with his wife, Clara, and dreaming of a better life. Failing to find work in Detroit's auto factories, he found himself living on the dole, drinking away his misery. A tiny, light-skinned man with a pinched face and sad, almond-shaped eyes, Elijah found salvation in 1931 when he heard Wallace D. Farad deliver a lecture at an old lodging hall. A year earlier, Farad, an ex-convict turned door-to-door silk salesman, had founded the Nation of Islam. He claimed that he was a Muslim from the holy city of Mecca, Saudi Arabia, and began using a variety of names: Wali Farad, Professor Ford, Farad Muhammad, and Wallace Farad Muhammad. He lectured on the history of the black man, biblical prophecy, and an unorthodox doctrine of Islam. Preaching out of basements and rented halls, he emphasized self-help and racial pride. Gradually, with Poole becoming his most devoted apostle, he built a sect with a few thousand members. Farad rewarded Poole by appointing him supreme minister and bestowing upon him a new name, Elijah Muhammad. But in 1933, Farad vanished amid accusations that he had ordered a human sacrifice. Shortly afterward, Muhammad proclaimed Farad's deification as Allah incarnate. After Farad's disappearance, Muhammad anointed himself the messenger of Allah and continued to build the nation, despite dissension and death threats against him from some members. Muhammad preached about the original man, Allah, a black man who created the universe. The Muslims believed that the so-called Negro was a descendant of the original man, who belonged to the tribe of Shabazz, an ancient group that founded the holy city of Mecca and eventually migrated to Africa. According to Muhammad, the origins of the white man could be traced back to Yaqub, an evil, big-head scientist. Nearly 6,600 years ago, Yaqub began preaching a dangerous version of Islam in the streets of Mecca. When authorities learned about his distortion of true Islam, he and his 59,999 followers were exiled to the island of Patmos in the Aegean Sea. There, Yaqub sought revenge by creating a devil race that would dominate the black nation through tricks, lies, and deception. Mutating the germs of the black man, Yaqub produced pale-faced, blue-eyed men who were weaker morally and physically. He planned for these devils to rule the earth for more than 6,000 years, testing the strength of the black nation. Muhammad prophesied that the white man's rule would end in 1970, after the Battle of Armageddon. Destruction of the white man, he foretold, would be carried out by the mothership, a wheel-shaped spacecraft a half mile wide. Piloted by the most intelligent black men, the mothership would carry 1,500 bombers. The plane could not be attacked, of course, because it could disappear behind the stars. In the days leading up to the resurrection, the mothership would litter the earth with pamphlets printed in English and Arabic, telling Allah's followers where to hide when the planes attacked. When the battle was over, the white man would be eliminated from the planet, and the black man would rise up from the smoldering ashes. In the 1960s, purported sightings of unidentified flying objects startled many Americans. But for followers of Muhammad, the presence of flying saucers portended that the Day of Judgment was near.
Context of White Supremacy. That will wrap up the second audio segment for next week. We were almost at the end of, this is chapter one still. We were almost at chapter two, but glad we went ahead and wrapped up here. We can pick up next week. We'll be on this book for a while, so we will have ample time to get back to it. Folks would like to participate, the number to dial, 641-715-3640, and the code is 564-943-pound. Press star 6 if you would like to participate. All the folks who dialed in, who were with us the first time around, should be here. If you have commentary you would like to share, please do not wait until the last minute. Program, we have a little less than 30 minutes left, so go ahead and get your hand up if there's something that you would like to share. If you have comments from the first audio segment that you did not get to share, you can get those in as well. But let's go ahead and share any thoughts, observations, questions folks would like to get in. Everyone who dialed in with a hand up should be with us.
Can I be heard?
Yes, sir.
Greetings, Gus. This is turning out to be a very interesting read. I'll just jump right into it. I'll start on page 8. There was a brief paragraph that I found to be very telling in as far as the way the system of white supremacy functions. He says, confronted with Clay's ego, Dundee discarded his own, becoming the ideal second banana. If Cassius said, I'm going to run 5 miles, Angelo responded, that's good for your legs. If Clay changed his mind and said, no, I'm going to rest, Dundee instantly added, good, you need your rest. This way, the fighter was in charge, even when he was not really in charge. Find that to be telling because this is what white people do to black people all day, every day. Even when you think you're in charge, you're not really in charge. And that's even in a lot of cases of your own life, a lot of the decisions that you make. You know, you're not really in charge of those decisions. You've been conditioned to make those decisions, and you're not consciously aware of it, myself included. So that is a constant struggle to fight to remain conscious of these things all the time. Dr. Ben used to speak about that quite often, the fact that as much information as he's brought to his people, that he was no less infested with racism as far as the effects of it as a black man and being a victim of it than anyone else. And that's something that I think that particular paragraph was telling and bringing out. The next thing I wanted to touch on was on page 11. There's a paragraph that says it was a strange sight to the white policeman who thought that a black man running across the highway furiously punching at the air must be crazy or a thief or both. In Miami, police frequently harassed blacks on the streets and raided black pool halls and bars. The officer stopped Clay to question him. Sweating and excited, Clay explained that he was running to Angelo Dundee's gym. The police then called Dundee to verify his own story. The trainer explained that the kid was his boxer. That's Cassius Clay, he said. The episode offered an important lesson for Clay. White policemen didn't know his name and didn't care to know it. To them, he was just another Negro. I just say nigger. Living across the tracks in the colored district, I say nigger district of Overtown. And what this says is, first, blacks do not have control over their own living space because it's not really theirs. It's white supremacists, and they allow us to live there until they gentrify it. And also, we don't have control of our own bodies, which he saw when being stopped and questioned about where he was running, that he couldn't just tell the officer to go screw himself and keep jogging. He had to answer those questions. The other thing is the way that this scenario took place reminded me of when slave masters would send their slaves on errands and give them a note so that if they were stopped by paddy rollers, i.e. police, essentially they could show the note stating that they were on an errand for their slave master, and that would be essentially their passport, which is that's the origin of the passport anyway, and ID was black code. So it's just very interesting. Like, this has a multi-layered deep understanding of how the system of white supremacy functioned then and in a lot of ways still functions today. The next thing I wanted to touch on was on the following page 12. The author writes, yet Clay quickly learned that the city's culture of racism remained intact. In August 1961, Flip Schulke, a white photographer from Sports Illustrated, visited Miami for a photo shoot with Clay. Schulke was a serious photojournalist who had traveled the world and taken memorable photos that appeared in leading American publications, but he had never photographed a boxer. Shopping at Berdine's department store, Clay picked up a short-sleeved shirt while Schulke snapped pictures. When the white store clerk saw the tall, lean black man touching the shirts, he informed him that store policy prohibited blacks from trying on clothing. Schulke fumed. It shocked him that Cassius Clay, an Olympic champion, could not try on a shirt in an American store. But Clay was not surprised. He wasn't even angry. This was the South. As a Southerner, he outwardly accepted second-class citizenship as a way of life. Come on, Flip. Don't worry about it, he said. I don't want to make a big mess here. It's not a big deal. I believe, seeming innocuous paragraph, but I believe the author was practicing racism, white supremacy, when he wrote the sentence, he wasn't even angry. This was the South? No, this was America. Let's be accurate, like you always say, accurate with words. This is America. The entire continent, including Canada, was racism, white supremacy of the highest and lowest order. So for him to use that term in this day and age, being that he wrote this book, a couple of weeks before Muhammad Ali passed away, to me, he's, to use your term, obfuscating the fact that the entire United States was the bastion of white supremacy for the entire white world. And, you know, I just think that that simple little word, the South versus America, reinforces the lies that we've been told for many, many generations, and that we still hear to this day that the South was the worst place for the black man, and the North was supposed to be somewhat better, when it was all the same crap, the same murders, lynchings, killings, you name it, and it's still happening now. Thank you for taking my call, and I'll mute my line.
Right on. Other folks who dialed in, if we have not heard from you.
I'm sorry. I missed one last thing.
Hang tight 1 second, because we had other people that dialed in that we hadn't heard from at all. Anybody that we have not heard from at all, if you dialed in with a hand up, you should go ahead and speak now if we haven't heard from you at all today. Any of the callers that we have not heard from at all, did you have comments that you wanted to get in?
Have you heard?
Yes, ma'am.
I'm looking on page 11 where it just, says that boxing could not satisfy his spiritual life. And I was thinking about, it says for a lot of us that, even if we have, I guess, so-called good jobs or things like that, that none of that answers the question of, like, what's going on with all, you know, how we're being treated and all of that. And he talks about on page 14, he was saying that it wasn't like when he was listening to Elijah Muhammad, he said it wasn't like the church teaching where he had to have faith what the preacher was preaching. And I was thinking that, you know, in churches they tell you to have faith and pray and all of that, and all of these problems that we're having are supposed to just mysteriously go away. And on page 16, it goes on to say that, you know, all of this, it all started to make sense to him because the Nation of Islam was like speaking to what was going on with black people and asking the questions about how we could solve our problem. And that's all I had.
I know one. Other folks that just trying to get the people who have not shared at all, are there other people who have a hand up who we have not heard from today? Okay, let's make sure we're not waiting until the last minute when we get ready to wrap things up. Last check, anyone that we have not heard from at all today, did you have comments you wanted to get in? Moving forward. So the other people who have not shared just the second audio segment, people who haven't commented yet from the second, after the second audio segment's conclusion, did you all have comments you wanted to get in?
Can I be heard?
Caller, female caller in Michigan, if you want to go first.
Oh, well, this is caller from the 712.
Oh, okay. Sorry about that. Go ahead, ma'am.
And on that word usage, that's very, very important, because he said that the father was remembering. Father said something about gruesome tales. He remembered his father's gruesome tales. And I said, gruesome tales? That was facts. That's something that actually happened. People were actually getting tortured, burned, lynched, castrated, all of it. And I took note of when he wrote that paper, I guess he wrote something about Islam or maybe the Nation of Islam. He wrote a paper and he almost was failed. And the principal had to stop it from him getting failed. And I also took note that Farad disappeared amongst rumors of ordering a human sacrifice. And I'm going to have to research more of that and see what was up with that. And those are the notes that I took from the last reading.
Right on. Retired firefighter, were you going to comment, sir?
Yes, sir. Being that the principal was brought up, he, from my understanding, he was a well-known figure in the area where Muhammad Ali grew up at. And he identified also, well before he became heavyweight champion of the world, that one day he would become heavyweight champion of the world. And it was the principal who prevented a young Cassius Clay from getting put back into high school another year and you know, basically graduated him from high school because he didn't want to go down in history as the principal who flunked Cassius Clay. Shoki, with all of those pictures that he took over the years of Cassius Clay, Muhammad Ali, it was compiled all into a huge book. And I wouldn't be surprised, I can't say for sure, but I wouldn't be surprised if he did not make a lot of money on those photographs that he took of Muhammad Ali in his early part of his career. The Nation of Islam member that for the most part had the most early influence on Muhammad Ali and his brother was commonly named down here in South Florida, Captain Sam. He was, you know, quite popular amongst the non-white black people who were Muslims in the South Florida area. I would say about the book, it's the most extensive reporting of Cassius Clay, Muhammad Ali's introduction to Islam, all compiled into one book. Even as early as we are in the book, I've never seen as much information on his entry. I've heard it all in different places, not compiled into one book. The situation about him and his writings in high school, and going into temples in major cities such as New York. And like I said, it was based on, because by that time he was so good as a fighter on the amateur level that he was able to, you know, when he would go to these different large cities for these tournaments like Golden Gloves and the national titles on the amateur level, he would visit a temple or two. It was later on that he actually met Malcolm X, and was quite interested because, you know, Malcolm's ability to articulate things was attractive to him. And was something else, but that's all I have for right now. Thank you.
For sure. Other folks, if we have not heard from you since the second audio segment concluded, if you have comments, feel free. Folks satisfied? Nobody else had comments that they wanted to get in if we haven't heard from you since the second audio segment concluded? Right on. Some of the notes that I took, and then we'll see if we maybe have time for anybody if they had anything quick that they wanted to get in before we conclude. This was from the prologue, the first audio segment, the portion where they talked about Andrew Wade IV and his wife Charlotte when they got a white people to purchase a home for them in Kentucky. That was Ann Braden. We talked about this before. This was, I think, 2014. We had a white woman on who did the biography of Ann Braden. This is a white woman who allegedly did a lot of things to work against racism through her life and times. In my view, she practiced white supremacy in asking Dr. King to do some dangerous things that would benefit her. And this was when Dr. King was already being tracked by COINTELPRO and threatened with death and everything else. She wanted him to come and do some things to help her out as a white person that she knew would put him in further danger. But that was Ann Braden. We've talked about that whole incident with the Wade family in great detail before, their house being bombed and everything that they went through in Kentucky. Moving forward into Chapter 1, the whole incident with him being stopped by the police, again, none of the things that are going on right now are new, and that's one of the reasons why I don't, I've said this for years, I really don't even have an interest in following and getting all emotional and riled up every time they have one of these police incidents, because this is standard operating procedure. This happens worldwide under the system of racism, white supremacy, and it's all areas of activity. This is happening on a daily basis. It's just you have to solve the system of white supremacy in order to stop these events, but this is, you know, long-running activity. Continuing where the sermon, this was, I thought it was so great because when we read, The Half Has Never Been Told, they mentioned, the white supremacist enslaver, Cassius Marcellus Clay. And I believe, one of our investors down in the Florida area, he called in and he said, wow, do you think Cassius Clay knew about the person that he was named after? And I said at the time, Cassius Clay is not a stupid person. I'm sure that he was informed. It just, you know, it would have surprised me if he didn't know about this. So boop, to have that pop up very early in the book, right on time. And I'm glad, because that was something that we had talked about earlier in the year. Continuing, just the extensive details about the exact FBI agent. They got his name and everything, Robert R. Nichols. Who was doing the investigation, and when he saw that Muhammad Ali, this is when he was very, very young, when he was a teenager, when he had come to Atlanta, Georgia, and he went to the Temple Number 15 to check out some of what was being talked about. They said, in fact, Cassius Clay, he was 16 at this point, and it's just, we're taking notes, boom, 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 boom. Detailed information. I mean, to have that sort of data, this is before he's won a gold medal. I mean, he's just another nigger at this point, nobody, you know, of any stature, and they've got documentation from that level. That's what I mean about it. It's staggering when you start to realize the intense magnification that black people are under in the system of racism, white supremacy. And again, this is the foolishness when whites insist that they are ignorant about racism. This is their major endeavor worldwide. This is how they're investing their time and energy, watching us when we're 14, 15, 16, 17 years old. Oh, wait a minute. Got to keep an eye. Oh, details on that. Write that down. Extensive. No, this is what they're doing. And I mean, you can just imagine now with the internet and all the other technology they have evolved. This is from the 1950s and 60s. You can only imagine what it is now. Continuing. Let's see. Yeah, I thought the school piece was important as well. And that is, you know, certainly current as well, where you can still be a black student if you are talking about racism, white supremacy, writing about racism, white supremacy. It can have a detrimental impact on your ability to graduate or to get good grades. I know we heard that from Dr. Umar Abdullah Johnson, where he said that it delayed him being able to get his PhD. I think we had one of our other guests on the program talked about his college experience. He reported the same thing, where he had been a great student, getting lots of A's, and then he wrote about racism, and oh man, everything dropped. Now they're talking about failing him and him getting like his lowest grade ever in a class. That's just standard operating procedure. This right here, I just talked about this last week. It came up again on the compensatory call-in in terms of our failure to accurately understand racism, white supremacy, and just not using the best words in articulating this problem and suggestions to it. When he says, they're talking about some of the teachings of the Nation of Islam, And he says, blacks and whites must separate because there could be no peace between God and the devil. This notion that, quote unquote, separation will solve the problem, it is not new. It has been suggested for many, many years, decades, centuries, even. It's totally false. It's false. And as some of the same things that I submitted last week, how would black people enforce it if we got land wherever in this part of the world, another part of the world? How would you enforce it to keep whites out? And then if you're talking separation, that would have to be all areas of people activity. How do you separate from whites' global financial system? They set the value on the currency. How would you do that? And I would just wait for explanations. And I mean, even if they're not, whites are not physically present, their domination, their terrorism is still going to be there. They can just poison your water supply. They don't have to be there for doing that. They could just send a drone and drop whatever chemicals that they want to do. How exactly would you manage this quote-unquote separation? It's just long running, and I hope that's something that we can get a better understanding of what racism, white supremacy is, how it works. You do not separate to solve that problem. Let's see. Also, just the significance of what white means, what black means. I think Malcolm X has a key portion in his autobiography where he talks about the same thing. I think many other people have pointed that out in terms of just being careful with the word. Why I say we should not be using the word fair at all in any manifestation, because it is the same thing. It's supporting this notion of white as purity, white as good, white as beautiful, white as logical, and the exact opposite for everything that is associated with black. Great information, and just looking forward to continuing the read and really being mindful of how these white authors are presenting us with this information. But there does seem to be a lot of it. I think retired firefighter said that as well. We have about 3 minutes. First, anybody that we haven't heard from at all, just making sure we didn't miss anyone that hasn't commented at all today. And anybody that we have not heard from since the second audio segment concluded, if you had a hand up, if you had anything you wanted to share from the second audio segment. Assume they're grand. Any final comments folks need to get in at all before we wrap things up?
Yes, I did have one thing I wanted to say. Funny enough, the part that I missed when I first spoke was exactly the paragraph where he wrote that paper, and his teacher wanted to fail him. And what stood out to me in that particular paragraph was the concept of no black unity. So in other words, him making some sort of spiritual and intimate connection to the message of the nation, from how they dress to their speech, as far as their understanding of white people, and the fact that they understood that these people were wicked, or given the position that white people are not trustworthy in any way, shape, or form. To me, that just said that from a young age, they were basically trying to just inculcate in him an idea of staying away from other black people, especially black people who were leading towards a path of truth and understanding as to what racism, white supremacy is, and how white people function. So that's, to me, that's what stood out most, is just the concept of the destruction of any sort of unification between black people. Thank you.
For sure. That book that was referenced, Flip Shulk, Muhammad Ali, The Birth of a Legend, that picture with Muhammad Ali in the swimming pool where he's underwater in the fighting stance, I think that's one of Flip Shulk's. I think that's one of the popular ones that a lot of people have seen. That's a lot of posters of that image and what have you. But I'm pretty sure he did make a lot of coins off of that book, because I've seen that book. It's like a really popular coffee table book, and probably even more so now with his recent passing. Also, this is probably a good book to check the reference section, because they have a lot of other books are mentioned, magazine articles, newspapers. If you want to check and get more details on some of the things that are being referenced, they referenced a documentary film, Muhammad Ali Made in Miami, which focuses on his time in the South Florida area and how that impacted his career, what he was doing, different fights that he trained for. It's a PBS documentary. You can check that out online. That was something that I went to do some searching myself because I had not heard of that one. And I mean, there's so much material on Muhammad Ali that you can probably do a lot of study, reading, film viewing, the whole nine if you're so interested. But check the reference section as we are rolling to kind of see where they're getting some of this information from if you would like to do further analysis. With that, we will stop there. We'll pick this one up again next Friday. We are right at the end of Chapter 1, getting ready to go into Chapter 2. We'll be here same program time, 8 p.m. Eastern, 5 p.m. Pacific next Friday. If you're listening to the archives and you have comments that you would like to share but you can't participate live, you can feel free to drop an email, untiljustice@gmail.com, untiljustice@gmail.com. And we will certainly read and include your commentary as we roll with the book. Huge thanks to all the folks for participating. Great hearing your commentary, and hopefully we will have an informative, enjoyable reading session with this book as well, White Authors Notwithstanding. We'll be here tomorrow. Compensatory call-in, 9 p.m. Eastern, 6 p.m. Pacific. Lots of things happening over the past week. We'll share observations, thoughts tomorrow. The Global Sunday Talk on Racism, that is this Sunday. It is at 3 p.m. Eastern, 2 p.m. Central, 12 noon Pacific. We should have folks tuning in from different spots around the globe to talk about. It's just been lots going on the past 7 days on a global perspective. Will be great to hear folks' thoughts on what has been going down. And then on Monday, Mr. Norm Stamper should be back, his fourth visit to the Context of White Supremacy. Seems he has been everywhere. He was on Democracy Now! This week. He was on News One. NPR did an interview with him. I mean, I was seeing him everywhere where he was talking about the police situation and racism and his new book. And he even used the term referencing how the police departments in this area of the world evolved from the patty rollers, the patrollers, to make sure that the enslaved black people were not running away and were behaving themselves. He did mention that explicitly in his time with my BFF, Amy Goodman, earlier this week. But he should be here Monday, normal program time, 8 p.m. Eastern, 5 p.m. Pacific. Again, if you have questions, guest suggestions, gripes, complaints, untiljustice@gmail.com. Again, I will encourage folks, sobriety would be best under conditions of white terrorism. Any opportunity or any incident where you have to have contact with an enforcement officer or just a regular white civilian, it could go bad, and I mean like lethal, in a matter of seconds. You do not want to make that encounter any worse by not being able to think clearly and make the best possible decisions to keep yourself safe, you and anyone that you might be responsible for. If you're in a vehicle, you certainly don't want to be under the influence, and that's whether you are the driver, passenger, even a pedestrian. You never know when it's going to be Daniel Holdsclaw, Darren Wilson, that is pulling up on you and about to make things very, very difficult for you under the system of white terrorism. Sobriety would be best, and again, if you're in a vehicle, buckle up. Let's do everything we can to minimize contact with race soldiers. Thanks, everyone, for tuning in. We will talk to you in about 24 hours. Creator, we ask that you help us remain patient with other black people, victims of white supremacy. We ask that you help us remain patient with ourselves. Remind us to demonstrate the highest levels of black self-respect at all times, in all places, each and every time we are in contact with another black person. It has been time. Replace white supremacy with justice immediately. Cal signing out. Thanks all for tuning in.
Nigga, you so brainwashed.
I'm a victim, brother.
No problem. You're a victim.
I'm a victim of 400 years of conditioning.
Shut up.
The man has programmed my condition. Even my conditioning has been conditioned.